This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. Inquest officers get bail. The National Security Minister says some officers have requested to be removed from frontline duty as well. A $350 million deal for Bahamar. And the Grand Bahama Port Authority launching a 45-day consultation period over their proposed rate increases for the power company. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strong. It is Morning Blend.
Wake up. It's a new day. Wake up. It's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way.
Don't you know that
it's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Thursday, September 19th, 2024. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Laverne Gardner will be joining us. Also this morning, more about BPL, what's happening there, and what the Managers Union has been saying about it. And concerns about bridges throughout the country. A bill passed that the government hopes will ensure the proper management of the bridges. We're going to get into that as well. That's all ahead, but first it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while you're sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, coroner Kara Turnquest-DeVoe granting bail to 11 policemen whom jurors found unlawfully killed suspects during police-involved shootings and ordered them to return to court on September 25th. That's when the officers will learn whether the Director of Public Prosecutions will act as the on the homicide by manslaughter verdicts. Of the jury is advisory and doesn't determine criminal or a civil liability. One of the officers, Constable Kevin Greenslade Jr., already has a pending trial in the Supreme Court stemming from the 2021 fatal police shooting of Danrico Carey in Nassau Village. He's accused of causing dangerous harm to Carey, while three other policemen are charged with his murder. An inquest was not held into Carey's death. Jurors returned a verdict of homicide by manslaughter against Greenslade and Police Constable Young in the death of Shanton Forbes. Greenslade Young, Inspector Akeem Wilson, who was the interested party in two inquests, including Constable Stirrup, Inspector H. Curtis, Constable Wright, Sweeting, Johnson, Roll, Brown, and Inspector Aaron Wilson, had their bail set at $9,500. Homicide by manslaughter verdicts were returned following inquests into the deaths of D'Angelo Evans, Shanton Monroe, Azario Major, Harold Brown, Richard Bastian, Ernest Forrest, and Elroy Stubbs. Meanwhile, the coroner issued arrest warrants for three policemen who failed to appear inquest into the 2022 shooting death of Valentino Johnson was held in the absence of Constable Shando King and Samuel Ferguson. King was fired from the police force after he was accused of attempted murder and firearms charges. The marshal, Angelo Whitfield, said that Ferguson had previously submitted a sick slip, but he was unsure. A warrant was also issued for Officer DeVoe after he failed to appear in court. No explanation was provided for his absence. DeVoe is an interested party in the May 23, 2017 shooting death of 15-year-old Gino Finley Jr. Meanwhile, some officers have petitioned Minister of National Security Wayne Monroe for help, asking to be removed from frontline duty since several policemen have been appearing in the coroner's court for inquests in police-involved shootings. Monroe said, making the comments to reporters when asked about what was happening in the coroner's court. Yesterday, Monroe, a former criminal defense attorney, said that while the legal process plays out, the public should not rush to judgment in any of the cases. He told reporters outside the house yesterday, quote, "The one thing that the public should not do is equate the fact that this has happened with the guilt of these officers. That would be against the process. There's some challenges that I've been confronted with since all of this has happened. There have been officers who've been asking me to intervene to remove them from frontline duty." The summons is corrected an oversight by the coroner who failed to inform the officers that they would be committed to the Supreme Court when the verdicts were delivered in compliance with the Coroner's Act. In other news from the courts, a man convicted of unlawful sexual intercourse is now a fugitive after he failed to return to court for sentencing. 26-year-old Quincy Edgecombe of Ross Corner pleaded guilty last month. Senior Justice Cheryl Grant Thompson allowed the sanitation worker to remain on bail before sentencing to permit him to get his affairs in order. The judge ordered Edgecombe's immediate arrest after describing him as a convict at large. Following his guilty plea last month, the court heard that Edgecombe, who was 25 at the time, met his 13-year-old victim on Instagram. On August 14, 2022, Edgecombe picked up the 8th grader and took her to her friend's house where they had sex. Although the child was a willing participant, she couldn't legally consent because she was under age 16. The Grand Bahama Port Authority has launched a 45-day consultation period with residents over the Grand Bahama Power Company's proposed rate increase. The port saying in a statement that to facilitate public understanding of the rate review and its potential impact and ensure transparency of the rate review process, the port's regulatory committee had prepared a summary overview of the key details and proposals outlined in the power company's application. Again, that's a 45-day community and stakeholder consultation period. The port saying that the review will include conversation and information sharing with stakeholders to gather diverse perspectives. And as Minister of Works and Family Island Affairs Clay Sweeting opened debate on the bridge, he said it will allow for better maintenance of bridges throughout the country. The Bridge Authority was created in 1998 to oversee the Paradise Island Bridge and the Surrey City Poitiers Bridge. While there are 40 bridges throughout the country, up to now the Bridge Authority has only been responsible for the Paradise Island Bridge. Sweeting says that while both the Paradise Island Bridge and the City Poitiers Bridge are in good condition, the condition of the other 38 bridges varies, with some having been recently replaced and others requiring urgent replacement. East Grand Bahama MP Kwesi Thompson raised concern over the state of bridges in his area, calling on the Grand Bahama Port Authority and Lukaya Service Company to conduct an assessment and undertake the necessary repairs. And the government is signing a heads of agreement with Bahamar for the development of the 350-room resort that will be at the site of the old Melia Nassau Beach. The project will be a $350 million investment and employ 400 Bahamians during construction and over 500 Bahamians upon completion. Overseas. Walkie-talkies exploded in Beirut and other parts of Lebanon on Wednesday in a second wave of attacks targeting devices a day after pagers used by Hezbollah blew up. That's according to state media and officials for the militant group. At least 20 people were killed and more than 450 wounded in the second wave, according to their health ministry. The attacks, which were widely believed to be carried out by Israel targeting Hezbollah, but have also killed civilians, They're raising fears now that the two sides' simmering conflict could escalate into an all-out war. Speaking to Israeli troops on Wednesday, Yoav Gallant saying that, quote, "We are at the start of a new phase in the war. It requires courage, determination, and perseverance." He made no mention of the exploding devices, but praised the work of Israel's army and security agencies, saying that the, quote, "results are very impressive." In Wednesday's attacks, several blasts were heard at a funeral in Beirut for three Hezbollah members and a child killed by exploding pagers the day before. Associated Press photographer in the southern coastal city of Sidon saw a car and a mobile phone shop damaged after devices exploded inside of them. The state news agency reported home solar energy systems blowing up in several locations, but experts cast doubt on whether those incidents were connected, saying they may have been coincidental accidents. And Haiti's government creating a provisional electoral council long sought by the international community to prepare the troubled Caribbean country for its first general election since 2016. A member of the country's transitional presidential council confirming with the Associated Press that the electoral council was created, albeit with only seven of what by law is supposed to be a nine-member panel. The member confirming that the two other members would likely be announced in upcoming days. The Electoral Council, which represents groups including farmers, journalists, human rights activists, and the Voodoo community, is tasked with organizing the elections and helping create the legal framework to hold them. Haiti has not had a president since July 2021, and it last held elections in 2016. The previous Electoral Council had been dissolved in September 2021 by Prime Minister Ariel Henry, who accused it of being partisan. His move delayed elections planned for November 2021 and prompted critics to accuse Henri of holding on to power, accusations he rejected. And a federal control board that oversees Puerto Rico's finances announcing that it will step in to help speed up projects to fix the island's crumbling power grid as widespread outages persist. Only $1.2 billion out of the more than $17 billion authorized by U.S. Congress to stabilize the U.S. territory's grid and improve reliability has been spent in the 7 years since Hurricane Maria hit the island as a Category 4 hurricane. A growing number of Puerto Ricans frustrated by the outages are demanding that the U.S. territory's government cancel its contracts with LUMA Energy, which operates the transmission and distribution of power. Several gubernatorial candidates have echoed that call, but the current governor has rejected such a move. In sports, from the WNBA, Bahamian Jonquel J.J. Jones and the New York Liberty have clinched the best record in the WNBA and the top seed going into the playoffs. They had a 32-7 win-loss record with one game to play. The Liberty's latest victory coming against the Washington Mystics with a score of 87-71 Tuesday. Jones making a significant contribution, scoring 11 points, grabbing 7 rebounds, and providing 5 assists. Liberty had an opportunity to clinch the top seed on Sunday, but fell to the Minnesota Lynx, 88-79. From Major League Baseball, the New York Yankees clinching a playoff berth by beating the Seattle Mariners 2-1 in 10 innings. And the LA Dodgers beating the Miami Marlins 8-4. Shohei Ohtani scoring his 49th base steal, moving closer to becoming the first player in Major League history with 50 homers and 50 steals in a season with that win. Wednesday night. The Milwaukee Brewers outperforming preseason expectations again to win the third National League Central title in 4 years. Back to the WNBA, the league is headed back to Portland with Oregon's biggest city getting an expansion team that will begin play in 2026. The team will be owned and operated by Raj Sports. They've paid $125 million for the franchise. Some 300 invited guests attended a kickoff event at Portland's Moda Center on Wednesday afternoon. The city is well known for embracing women's sports. In addition to the Thorns are drawing more than 18,000 fans on average to each home game, Portland is home to the nation's first bar exclusively for women's sports in the U.S. The Sports Bra, which opened in 2022, recently announced plans for additional franchises. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. Weather for today, we've got a mid to upper level trough that continues to interact with abundant tropical moisture across the country, supporting bouts of unsettled weather over portions of the Bahamas through tonight. The mid to upper level trough will begin to move toward the east and dig further south into the Western Caribbean Sea by Friday, and that's going to mean moisture is going to move across the country, maintaining a moist and unsettled weather pattern heading into the weekend. Starting with a new work week, weak high pressure will support gentle to moderate easterly winds. There remains an elevated risk for severe weather activity over the country today throughout the weekend. Heavy and prolonged rainfall may lead to flooding, especially in low-lying, already saturated areas. Motorists and all road users should exercise caution while along coastal roadways during high tide, especially. Minor coastal erosion is possible due to the presence of king tides. That should continue through Monday. And we're expecting high UV and heat indexes and getting back up into the triple digits. So everyone's being advised to remain hydrated and limit outdoor activities during peak sunshine hours. So for today, forecast for the northern Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, to cloudy, a 30 to 50% chance of showers and thunderstorms. Showers can become heavy and thunderstorms strong to severe at times. Wind southerly at 10 knots or less. For the northwest Bahamas, including New Providence, cloudy today, a 30 to 50% chance of showers and isolated thunderstorms. Again, showers can be heavy and thunderstorms strong to severe at times. Wind southeasterly at 10 to 15 knots. And for the central Bahamas, variably cloudy, 20 to 40% chance of showers and thunderstorms. Winds east to southeast at 10 knots or less. And for the southeastern islands, a mix of sun and clouds today, partly cloudy tonight, 20 to 30% chance of isolated showers and thunderstorms. Winds east to southeast at 10 to 15 knots, falling light and variable at times. Temperature-wise today, look for highs in the upper 80s. Lows in the upper 70s, but the heat index will be a factor, making it feel like it's 100, 101 Fahrenheit, 41 Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. We'll have your extended outlook and look at the tropics coming up in just a bit. Your first look at weather brought to you by Scotiabank. Be a fraud fighter. Sharing isn't always caring. Keep your personal and financial info private. Never share account details with anyone. A friendly reminder from Scotiabank. You are listening to Morning Blend. When we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on your home for fresh news and smart talk. Guardian Radio 96.9.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So the bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Living with a neurological condition shouldn't define you. At Cleveland Clinic in Florida, we do whatever it takes to make life better today while discovering new treatments for a brighter tomorrow. From epilepsy management to specialized spine care and brain tumor surgery, we're delivering world-class neurology care for the day-to-day, for the days you live for every care in the world. Visit clevelandclinicflorida.org/Caribbean.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Do you have uncontrollable debt? Are you ready to make that move to Fidelity for a stress-free future? These loans have a built-in savings plan that pays you unbeatable interest. Ask about our debt consolidation loans today. Call 356-7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, on 6.9 FM.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way. Don't you know that it's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Float Channel 612. You can tweet us at Morning Blend 969, facebook.com/Morning Blend 969, and text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 4224796. Standard text rates apply. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. Joining me now, Laverne Gardner. Laverne, good morning. Laverne, are you there? Are you muted?
Good morning.
Ah, great to be talking with you as always.
Yeah, likewise.
How are things in Grand Bahama today?
Yeah, I guess.
Oh, boy. Okay. Hey, Grand Bahama's in the news. We're going to talk about that in a bit. All right, so we've been stood up by all of our planned guests today, and all are government related, but I don't know what that means, but that's fine.
Yeah.
We'll figure that out. So, yeah. But there is a lot to talk about. Let's do that right now with what's in the news. All right, so that means since it's just you and me, Laverne, we're going to get to talk about so many things that we need to talk about, including some things we didn't get to yesterday, BPL and what the Managers Union is saying, and what's in the news today. We've got there's more on the Valley Boys, drama. both groups reacting to the JCMP's final verdict. And they're all threatening legal. Everybody's threatening legal action. So we'll get to that. I know a lot of people are very tired of talking about this. But hey, public money is involved in this. I think we do need to look into this. So there's police officers who were in court and getting bail, and that's a very interesting thing going on there. And a $350 million deal for Bahamar, planning a 350-room hotel. $350 million deal and a 350-room hotel. Okay. And that's going to be the site of the old Melia, the old Cable Beach Hotel, which came down with little fanfare not too long ago. But exciting for those folks there. So great stuff. But there's, as we said, Grand Bahama in the news as well. And bridges. We'll get to the bridges in just a bit. I do want to talk about that. But Grand Bahama Port Authority launching a 45-day consultation period over the proposed power rate increases. Our Travis Cartwright Carroll writing about it today. The Grand Bahama Port Authority has launched a 45-day consultation period with residents in Grand Bahama over the Grand Bahama Power Company's proposed rate increase. In a statement, the port said, to facilitate public understanding of the rate review and its potential impact and ensure transparency of the rate review process, GBPA's regulatory committee has prepared a summary overview of the key details and proposal outlined in GBPC's application. It said that as we commence this 45-day community and stakeholder consultation period, our review will include conversation and information sharing with stakeholders to gather diverse perspectives. Following the consultation period, which ends November 4th, 2024, GBPA's regulatory team and its regulatory consultant will thoroughly review the proposed application. This review will fully consider all information and feedback presented to determine what is reasonable for customers at this time before issuing a final decision on the rate application on December 2nd, 2024. GBPC is seeking a 6.3% increase in the base rate for electricity. 2 years ago, the company was granted approval by the Grand Bahama Port Authority for a 3.4% increase to the base rate. The port said that the power company proposed investments of $8.4 million over the next 3 years, focused on enhancing. And in the statement, it says these include the significant upgrades to transmission and distribution infrastructure slated at a cost of $3 million to support growth in a critical area, as well as battery storage investments of $4.5 million to aid in the capture and efficient use of energy generated from solar systems. And it says that in outlining the all-in rate impact of various customer classes, the power company's filing states that residential general service, large and large industrial customers' all-in costs remain relatively unchanged in the first year, with less than a 1% change from current all-in costs. While there will be varying adjustments each year, the all-in cost is projected to reach its maximum increase of 4% in 2026 before leveling off, with a 2.5% change in 2027 from current rates. And the story goes on to talk about the controversy, of course, with the government believing that ERCA is the regulator for all utilities in the country, but of course the port believes that it is for Grand Bahama, or at least the Freeport area. All right, so Laverne, since we last spoke about it, how is the reliability at the moment of your electricity after all those challenges we're having?
At the moment, it's been okay. You know, I am cautiously optimistic, but I will admit that whenever it gets over, which it was for, like, not yesterday, maybe Monday and Tuesday in the morning, I do get nervous thinking, okay, my power may go out. Mm-hmm. My power did go out for, I think, about 30 minutes, maybe, on Monday. 30 minutes on Monday. I don't know if you saw me posting, I think Friday, my power was out for a total of 10 hours.
What now?
Yeah.
10?
I think it was a, yeah. Yeah, my power went off at 12:29, and it came back on at 8:40.
12:29 a.m.?
Yeah. No, 12:29 p.m.
Okay.
And came back on at 8:40 p.m. And then it went back off at 9:44 and came back on 11 or thereabouts. I have the time written down somewhere. But we saw crews working in our area and they were changing the pole. So I think that has been the longest power outage that we had experienced. Yeah. So, but I would say since Tuesday, Wednesday, knock on wood, we haven't had any more outages.
Well, okay. Well, yeah.
We'll
if
see.
You say two or three weeks, then they say, well, improvement. But two or three days, yeah, it's a little
early. Right, that's why I'm saying, you know, I'm just monitoring it. I'm not about to say, yes, we're good.
Yeah.
No.
But you said you get nervous
it
when
it's...
It hasn't
been enough time.
Yeah. You say you get nervous when it's overcast. But, I mean, was that the issue on Friday?
No.
Oh, so exactly.
No, what happened? I don't know what happened. It was just, I get nervous when it's overcast because I'm just thinking, oh my gosh, this power is going to go out. Mm-hmm. But no, I guess they were, customer service could not clearly articulate to me what the issue was. They could only say that there was an issue and that their crews were working to remedy it. Mm. Until about maybe after 7 or so. That I actually saw some crews work. They may have been working in another area, but we saw them working and then saw them changing or putting down a pole. So I sat there and watched that. That was my entertainment as I tried not to pass out from the heat. But yeah.
My goodness.
So as I said, you know, I'm counting the days. I'm not going to jump up and down. Yeah.
Mm. Okay, so what could possibly be, could you possibly hear during this consultation period that would make you, after going through all of this, say, yeah, I think the power company deserves to raise my rates?
Okay, so a couple of things. The first thing that is,
what? Is that you censoring yourself? What was that? We heard nothing. So that's the answer. Nothing?
That's it. There is absolutely nothing.
It was either nothing or bleep, 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 bleep. Okay. Well, we get the picture loud and clear. Wow. Thank you very much, Laverne.
There's absolutely nothing at this point that would...
Oh,
that
dear
would be
Lord.
Acceptable
that was
to
beautiful.
Me.
All right. So what about your friends and family there on Grand Bahama? Do you think they're like, you know, anybody thinking that? Well, I think they made a really compelling case.
I do not believe that anyone would say that they have made a compelling case regardless of what they presented.
Mm-hmm.
Last week, or the week before, I think it was last week, Darren Cooper, the Corn Swain, had a meeting. You know, that was when we were going through all, that was coming off of going through all those consistent load shedding, you know, power outages, you know, because I was just keeping you up to date. I was like, okay, my power's off again.
Yeah, that was getting very annoying, by the way, because it was every few minutes, it seemed like.
Yeah, but I had to annoy someone.
Thank you.
Other than the people that I already annoyed here. So I was like, you know what? Sharing is sharing. But anyway, they had a meeting with the Grand Bahama Port Authority, and the Quan Swain actually, you know, penned a letter, posted it on Facebook, just kinda talking about what the conversation was like, talking about the temporary generators that they brought in so that we could have consistent power outage so that we won't have load shedding. And, you know, the power company did say that they're renting these and eventually, or, you know, in the short time frame, because two of their bigger units were down and they're working to get them up. And so maybe by November, they'll have it up. In the meantime, they're renting this. One of the things that he said was that, yes, they're going to pass this additional cost because what they're running requires them to burn more fuel and it's costly. And so that's going to be passed on to the consumer.
Wow.
So what are you saying to me? We're not, it's not happening. There's nothing that you can say at this point for us as Grand Bahamians that we are willing to accept, that we are going to say to you, it's okay.
Mm.
Because it seems to me, in my finite understanding, that nobody, we are always taking the loss. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody says that. This is the company we're doing this business. Our equipment failed. It's our responsibility to get the equipment up. This is the cost of doing business. No, it's our equipment failed or isn't working or whatever it is.
Right.
We have to spend more money, so you are going to have to pay. So we are paying you already when we use it, it doesn't work, and you have to now get additional equipment or whatever, because you cannot do what you are obligated to do, we still also have to pay.
Right. Wow.
So what can you say that's going to make us in Grand Bahama say, okay, even if you explain everything, even if you show us the books, I'm just saying, and you have a compelling case, at the end of the day, we're not walking away saying, okay, I see what they're saying.
Well,
we're not doing that. That's not happening.
Well, this is going to be very interesting to see how the regulator, in quotation marks, right, the GBPA responds to this. They're in a very tough position here. But anyway, we will see. We will see. Want to hear from...
Two years ago, the regulators already approved base rate increase. That was 2 years ago.
Just two. Yep.
That was just 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
As you are aware, we're still paying this storm recovery. Hey, man, come on.
Mm. Wow. All right. So because
the storm clearly was our fault.
My goodness. Want to hear from you folks. If you're in Grand Bahama, give us a call. You can call us toll free, 242-300-5720. And you can call in our regular lines, 323-6232-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. All right, so while that's going on, we've got our own issues here in the rest of the country dealing with BPL. I think they're in competition to see who can annoy customers the most. BPL... This was a story yesterday. We said we'd get back to it, and our Candia Dame's writing about it. Executives with the Bahamas Electrical Utility Managerial Union, they're saying that they have been left confused by answers provided to them by Minister of Energy and Transport Joe Beth Colby Davis regarding the future employment of union members, declaring that workers are still out in the cold as the government drives ahead with critical changes to the structure of BPL. So the managers' union... President Christopher Hanna saying in a Zoom meeting with members, quote, after reading the letter that was forwarded to the union by the Minister of Transport and Energy, I am more confused than I was before and not up to par. And from the answers, I do not recommend that any BPL employee move over to BGC. That's Bahamas Grid Company. Colby Davis sent in answers to the union's questions in correspondence dated September 12th. Under the government's 25-year contract with Pike Corporation, which has not been made public, despite the fact that Pike trucks are all over New Providence, doing all kinds of work, tons of work crews, Pike, Pike. You see Pike more than BPL. Anyway, the contract has not been made public, and whose finalization has never been announced. Not yet. Pike, through its Bahamian management company, Island Grid Solutions, will upgrade and manage the transmission and distribution network on New Providence. Under the joint venture partnership, the government will own 40% of the shares in the special purpose vehicle called Bahamas Grid Company, and Island Grid will own 60%. Bahamas Grid will hire the New Providence T&D employees at BPL for a period of 1 year, after which they will have the opportunity to remain with Bahamas Grid or return to BPL. Now, the union wants clarity on those arrangements, specifically not been forthcoming. One of the questions the union asked the minister was when the secondment period will start. Colby Davis advised that it will start in early 2025 in a phased approach. According to the minister, impacted staff will be advised well in advance of the implementation date of this voluntary exercise. The union asked what the management structure will look like at BPL with the creation of Bahamas Grid. The minister advised that the management structure will be different at the two companies, but said the two management teams will collaborate. Now, this is the union president again, Hannah. He told members, quote, "The answer to that question, number one, was definitely too vague. We asked what would the management structure look like with the formation of Bahamas Grid. She never answered the question, what will the management structure look like?" The union also asked for specifics on the time frame of the restructuring exercise, and the minister said, quote, "As it relates to the secondment of T&D employees, our current expectation is that secondment will commence in early 2025 through a phased approach. This phased approach will address project needs based on system requirements and the prioritization of projects agreed by technical teams from both BPL and BGC. To ensure that the transition process is transparent and fair, the transition committee will assist BPL's HR department in this exercise." But the union believes the transition committee should already have been formed and operational if the changes are indeed taking place in early 2025. It is almost October of 2024, no? So 2025 is pretty much here. Very, very close. If you're trying to... Anyway, this is Hannah again. He says, quote, "I believe if they were serious, and they ain't serious... If they were serious, this would have been done a long time ago." That's a quote. He also believes that stating that the secondment will happen in early 2025 is too vague. Yes. The union questioned why the one-year deadline is in place for employees to possibly return to BPL when Island Grid's contract is for 25 years. Need to read that again. The union questioned why the one-year deadline is in place for employees to possibly return to BPL when Island Grid's contract is for 25 years. The union asking, shouldn't the mechanism for return by employees align with the new company's contract period of 25 years? Colby Davis responded to this. She said, "The one-year secondment window is an exclusive, limited-time opt-in opportunity for BPL T&D staff to become familiar with the advancements in the utility space, training, development, and upskilling, while maintaining BPL employment status with the option to continue growing as a T&D professional with BGC." What?
I'm not clear.
What is that?
I'm not clear.
What does that mean?
I'm sorry, Glenn.
That sounds
like, I don't
that
know.
That sounds like, you know, you put something in a computer and ask it to come up with, shoot out something that sounds
That's not
smart.
Clear to me. I'm confused here. I'm confused really because if Bahamas Power and Grid.
Mm-hmm. Grid? If Bahamas, yeah, Grid. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No.
If they are going to be responsible for transmission and distribution, what is BPL responsible for?
Mm-hmm.
What are they responsible for? What are they going to be doing?
Sending out bills. Okay, so let's read on. This is a long article. Let me read a little bit more. So that was just a lot of fancy talk.
That was a lot of words.
Interesting. I don't know what Anyway, the union trustee Anthony Outen responded at the meeting saying, quote, "The answer says it's an exclusive limited time opt-in opportunity, but the letter also says this secondment is a voluntary exercise. It's not forced. So we have to ask ourselves, why is it that the company is putting this in such a manner that it's being forced upon persons?" And that is what they are saying, that it's not being forced. So if persons decide that they do not want to take this opportunity, what happens in the long term? The union executives called the minister's position confusing and contradictory. Saying, this is Hannah again, saying, quote, "I believe you're jumping on a train and you don't know where the train is going when you talk about opt into something that you know nothing of." The union also asked the minister whether BPL employees will still have the option to return to BPL after the one-year deadline passes, for example, 5 to 10 years later. What will there be to return to?
I just want to say, what would you be returning to? Because it seems as if this company is going to be doing everything other than, what did you say, Dwight? Sending out bills?
Bills and meter reading.
Right. So what is it exactly that you would be returning to? You know, once everything is done in early 2025, what does BPL look like? What is BPL going to look like? If I'm an employee and I said, you know what, I don't want to go over to Bahamas Power and Grid.
Bahamas Grid.
Bahamas Grid. I don't want to go.
It could be Island too. Bahamas Power Island Grid. I don't know. But yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Bahamas Grid, though, technically. BGC.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't want to go over. So what does my employment status look like? Am I still... I'm in the transmission and distribution department.
Yeah.
But I don't want to go over to Bahamas Grid. So what does my employment look like?
I believe this is for New Providence, right? I believe it's specifically for New Providence.
What does my employment
maybe
look like?
Maybe you'll be transferred to a family island. Maybe you'll have to be. Maybe that's it. I don't know.
Right.
And will people be into that? Wow. Let's see if there's...
And if I decide 5 years later, you know what? I want to go back to BPL. What does that mean?
Yeah.
Do I lose my years? What does that look like?
All right, let's see if we can find any more clarity in this article. So Colby Davis, in response to the union asking about that, what if you do want to return 5 or 10 years in? Colby Davis said, quote, "BPL employees under secondment will have the automatic right to return to BPL within that one-year window as per the secondment guidelines. If the employee decides not to stay with BGC, this will allow for the proper resource planning within both organizations." But she didn't respond. That's not answering the question.
Pardon me?
That's not answering the question.
That's why I said pardon. Missed it.
So this is back to the union on their Zoom call. The answer suggests that secondment guidelines have already been drafted, but yet we, the executive members here, have not been involved in any of the discussions. So when they talk about inclusion, obviously we've not been included. And after the 1 year, if you stay there more than a year, there's no coming back for you. That's what it seems to suggest, hey? The union asked the minister, quote, "If a BPL employee from field operations who was forcibly transferred to Bahamas Grid..." What?
It's voluntary.
It sounds like you're getting transferred from one plantation to the other. You don't have a say in it. Oh, man, that doesn't... Oh, wow. Okay. Forcibly transferred to Bahamas Grid, returns to BPL at the one-year deadline, what area will they report to? The minister said, quote, the secondment window is an exclusive opt-in. What? This is the same response.
I feel like you're saying
talking to a robot.
Same thing, Dwight. I feel like you that's your response. You're saying the same thing.
I'm only reading what she said.
You're reminding me, but it feels like it's the same thing.
It feels like a movie about talking to a robot in the future.
She responded,
listen to this. "The secondment window is an exclusive opt-in opportunity available to BPL to read this at a robot file. BPL T&D employees to exercise work, to experience work at BGC for a limited time. Furthermore, no employee will be forcibly transferred to BGC. Through this opportunity, the said employee will be exposed to new advances in the utility space, as well as training, development, and upskilling." Employees who take advantage of the BGC's secondment opportunity and return to BPL within the one-year time frame will be placed in available positions with benefits and tenure intact.
Okay.
Oh my God.
And an available position. So it's not necessarily the position that they left. It may be.
We need to reenact this as a play. And you have the, you know, and then have the minister's voice be that like voice from, what are some of those movies where you're talking to an AI? So the union vice president, Kevin Gilbert, responded, quote, "So basically an employee or employees who within a year say, I want to go back to BPL. What that is saying to me is that they're not sure if they're going to have a job. There's no place to put those persons. So from our perspective, that leaves our union members out in the cold. The union also wants to know if the tenure and benefits would remain in place if workers decide to stay with BGC, whether they would be in a unionized environment, and if there would be a different union." Colby Davis said, quote, "The union will be recognized as the sole bargaining agent for all current BPL union members during secondment for matters relating to BPL benefits."
Okay, but what about matters relating to the BGC?
Union General Secretary Graham McKinney said, "So this suggests to us that the benefits are only going to be available during this opt-in period, which means, as was answered from question one, BPL, it means that benefits will fall away after the one-year secondment period, which means if you had 15 years, if you had 9 years, if you had 6 years, you start over." The president said, "I want to add to this. So this means that if 90% of BPL staff signs over to this new company, that means that after a year, the union is actually dissolved. Is this a form of union busting?" And another union member said, "It could also be that our failing and underfunded pension falls away." Well, they're asking some good questions, but does the minister have the answers? The union asked whether it will be the sole bargaining agent for the new staff members, for new staff members at BGC. Oh, this is going to be interesting. Colby Davis said, quote, "The union is the bargaining agent for BPL employees in accordance with the industrial agreement, which only speaks to Bahamas Power and Light."
Right. Okay, so what happens then? So do they have to now form another union if they decide to go over to BGC?
You ever?
What protection do they have?
You ever started a union before at a new company, Laverne?
Uh-uh.
Oh, okay. Ask people who tried. What happens to them?
Yeah. So I don't know. A lot of questions.
Yes.
A lot of answers, but maybe not answers to the questions with that.
And there's more on this. Again, this was in yesterday's NASA Guardian. You got to pick up a copy of this or find this online on the NASAGuardian.com. It is a fascinating story, and this is a scary time, not just for us as consumers, but definitely for everybody at BPL. And my God, what have we gotten ourselves into here? And the Pike trip to this Bahamas grid, island grid, or is it just they're working on a different contract, a different something, a project? We don't know. Very little clarity. Nobody's talking. Mm-hmm. Just sounding like robots. Let's hear what you have to say before we have to take a break, folks. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Toll free 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us 422-4796. Good morning, caller. You are on the air.
Yes, good morning. How are you this morning?
Doing well.
Morning. Well, I'm so disappointed with the news of BPL. I mean, I am 50. I'm just as old as this country. My children have nothing left, darling. Nothing. Everything that they have said, Mr. Pinlin, from the 60s and the 70s, they fight to put in place. It's being taken away bit by bit. And it's sad. There's no more BPL for my children. I have sons. Where they going to work? In the bush? What's for us and our children? This is wrong. And we have no recourse. And they sit up in their big houses and they would ever have you sipping their tea and feel no way about us. All that we have gotten is being, I watch it being taken back. BPL, BTC, what next? NIB? My God, I tell my children, and I slave hard for them. And I'm a single mother, so that's even another topic. I tell my children when they don't get educated with their big-time master's and bachelor's degree, and I fight for them to get all their scholarships. I tell them, don't come back, because I don't know what you're coming back to, honey. I don't know what you're coming back to, my love, and this is sad. This is breaking my heart about this. I don't know what we can do.
Wow. Yeah, very, very scary. Thank you very much for calling in. I appreciate it. Boy, let's take another call. Good morning. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Devine.
Hi.
Morning.
I mean, it sounds like Kong sounded to me. But my question is, where will we be paying our bills, the BPL or Pike? Who will be collecting the revenue?
I don't know. I mean, I'm sure it'll be BPL.
We're not sure.
But I am not sure. But probably BPL. I couldn't tell you. I have no idea.
Yeah, exactly. No Just idea. Leave it at that. Like you say, no I don't idea. Know.
Okay. Well, you know, the minister, she got some explaining to do, man. She need to come and make it clear. We are still waiting on the details that the prime minister promised us as soon as that the ink is dry, we will get the details.
The details, that's true.
And, you know, there's so many things we're still waiting on the details for that, yeah. You know, we haven't gotten.
We've forgotten some of the things we're waiting on details for.
You know, right, I don't know. But we wait.
Mm-hmm.
But he did say, Dwight, that your bills will go down from now on. Expect that between now and the next year, you will have no more problems.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. All right, one more call, and we've got to get to your messages. No? Okay. This message coming in, let Dwight Strawn and Laverne Gardner know that the power is off in sections of Freeport, Grand Bahama, from the mayor of Grand Bahama.
Oh, boy. Oh, wow.
I hope we didn't jinx it. Do we jinx it by talking about it?
I hope not.
Because, you know, every time
Mayor
I talk
Grand
about
Grand Bahama,
power,
wherever, which area are you calling from, well, texting from, that's off. I'm currently not off, right? So which area are you texting from?
Let's see if we can squeeze this call in before we get to some other messages. Yeah, okay. Good morning, caller. You're on the air, live.
Good morning, Dwight. How are you doing?
Doing well.
And good morning, Laverne.
Good morning.
Wonderfully, this is the GNN.
NN, yes, sir.
And I want to sing a song for you and Dwight and the Nation.
Oh, my.
Oh,
you
Lord.
Talk
okay.
too much. Mm-hmm. We talk about this and we talk about that. We talk about that and we talk about this. Behemoths talk. We talk too much.
Mm-hmm. What do you suggest we should do instead of talking?
We need to make up our minds that what these successive administrations are doing to us, we need to stop the talk and we need to act. Faith without works is dead. The Bahamian people have been taken for a ride for 51 years. 51. And the only thing we do is talk and chai lai wearing red and chai lai wearing orange or yellow, whatever the other color is, and we can go right back to the poll. And Laverne, I can get on you this morning for Freeport, and y'all gonna go right back to the poll, and y'all gonna do the same thing over and over and over again.
Mm.
So I ain't feel sorry for the Bahamians, and BTC was a perfect example, and the BPL union sitting right there on doing hoping, wishing, and praying.
Wow,
thank
I hear you.
You.
Thanks so much. All right. Well, hey, we got to go to the break. We'll pick up in just a bit. I'll read all your text messages about this. We've got a lot to talk about on this Thursday morning. Sorry, God, I'm going to talk. Can't do anything during the show. Maybe right after. Catch me outside, I guess. I don't know. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Talk too much. You talk about people that you never seen. You talk about people you can make me scream. You just talk, talk too much.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is AP News. I'm Rita Foley.
We'll begin in the Middle East, where Israeli Defense Minister Yoav Gallant says we are at the start of a new phase in the war, though he didn't mention those exploding devices that went off over the past few days. The AP's Karen Shamas.
Lebanon has been rocked again by exploding devices as walkie-talkies blew up around the country, killing at least 20 people and wounding more than 450. The attacks, which were widely believed to be carried out by Israel targeting Hezbollah but have also killed civilians, came a day after pagers used by Hezbollah exploded, killing at least a dozen people, including children, and injuring thousands. Eye surgeon Dr. Elias Sharad said,
"The one who did it is a criminal. Is a monster."
Speaking to Israeli troops, Israeli Defense Minister Yoav Gallant made no mention of the exploding devices, but praised the work of Israel's army and security agencies. Experts have said booby traps are banned under international law. I'm Karen Shamas.
The House says no.
The House rejected a Republican-backed bill that would have prevented a partial government shutdown October 1st into a mandate that states require proof of citizenship when people register to vote.
The AP's Donna Warder reporting. Authorities say they think they found the body of a man suspected of shooting and wounding five people on a Kentucky interstate highway on September 7th. The body found following a search of rugged terrain in southeast Kentucky is believed to be that of Joseph Couch. The Teamsters say they are not endorsing either candidate in the presidential election, Donald Trump or Kamala Harris. Overseas now, a plane that was used for humanitarian work by the World Food Program was damaged during an Islamic attack in the capital of Mali. That's according to the South African aviation company that owns the plane. It says the crew and staff are safe. This is AP News. Now to Sean Diddy Combs.
A second judge has refused to grant bail to musician Sean Diddy Combs. A day after federal magistrate Robin F. Tarnowski ruled that Sean Diddy Combs was too dangerous to go free, U.S. District Judge Andrew L. Carter also denied bond for Combs. Carter says prosecutors gave convincing evidence that Combs could potentially tamper with witnesses. Combs pleaded not guilty on Tuesday to charges that include racketeering, sex trafficking, obstruction of justice, and drug offenses. Combs' attorney had offered to post $50 million bail for home detention at Combs' mansion in Miami. Combs has been held at the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn since his arraignment. I'm Margie Zaraletta.
The hidden figures of the space race have been recognized with Congress's highest honor at a medal ceremony. The Congressional Gold Medal was presented Wednesday to the families of several black women honored for their work in the early days of the space program. I'm Rita Foley, AP News.
It is time for your first look at traffic for the morning pollution with RBC. In real-time traffic, we've got a number of hotspots to tell you about. We've got Prince Charles Drive, especially near Beatrice Avenue. So westbound traffic on the way to, and even as you head beyond that to Soldier Road, you're going to be seeing that slow-moving traffic there. And that's going to lead you into Robinson Road, always busy and slow-moving westbound there. Soldier Road at that intersection straight up to Bernard, Wolf, and Village Road. Heavy, slow-moving northbound traffic. Eastern Road got a number of interesting traffic issues there. But you're going to be not moving east and west of Fox Hill Road if you're heading northbound, westbound. And things will ease up a bit for you once you get past Johnson Road. But there's well east of Camperdown on Eastern Road. For some bizarre reason, seeing some heavy traffic out there. Some odd stuff. All right, so Carmichael, westbound to Coral Harbor Road. Slow-moving traffic there as well. And, of course, Milo Butler Highway from Fire Trail straight up to Tawny Gwynn's Darling Highway. Slow-moving northbound traffic at this hour. Things looking better. Slightly better for you on Glasson Road, but it's still busy there northbound at this hour. That's what we're seeing. We'll have another update for you after the 8 o'clock news. That's Morning Blend Traffic, brought to you by RBC. Start a conversation at rbc.com/loan/all of you. And time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by the Hit Spot. We've got a severe weather warning in Bahama, North Abaco, and their Keys and adjacent waters, and a severe weather warning in effect for Bimini and its Keys and adjacent waters. Well, that's been canceled, but it's now on Eastern Grand Bahama and North Abaco. That's in effect until 8:30 a.m. The Department of Meteorology says their lightning detection radar and satellite imagery depicting a cluster of heavy showers and embedded thunderstorms slowly moving east and southwards across these areas. Showers and thunderstorms associated with a mid to upper level trough west of the northern Bahamas, coupled with a very moist and unstable air mass moving across these areas, will result in showers with locally heavy and severe thunderstorms, causing strong gusty winds, dangerous lightning, and heavy downpours, possible hail and waterspout activity. So it's going to be that kind of day today. Again, your forecast for the northern Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, partly cloudy to cloudy, a 30 to 50% chance of showers and thunderstorms. Some will be heavy and severe at times. The northwest Bahamas, including New Providence, cloudy. Again, a 30 to 50% chance of showers and thunderstorms. Variably cloudy to a mix of sun and clouds for the central and southeast Bahamas today. In your extended outlook for tomorrow, Friday, partly cloudy to cloudy, 30 to 50% chance of showers and thunderstorms again for the northern and northwest Bahamas. By Saturday, partly cloudy to cloudy once more, and again, a 30 to 50% chance of showers and isolated thunderstorms for the northern and northwest Bahamas. That's going to hold into Sunday and Monday. We'll take a look at the tropics in our next weather check after the news. This weather check brought to you by the Hit Spot. Take advantage of their September special, $79.99. for their band extender, so you can listen to Guardian Radio in your Japanese domestic market vehicles. The Hit Spot on Soldier Road.
RBC. Life is full of twists, turns, and defining moments that create your own unique story. However your story unfolds, we're here to help guide you through it. From every big decision to every new adventure, RBC. Visit rbc.com/Caribbean/all of you.
When you jump in your Japanese import and you turn the radio on, all you hear is... For the month of September, the Hit Spot will install a band extender in your Japanese import for the discounted rate of only $79.99, VAT included. Get your band expander installed today at the Hit Spot and listen to
Star 106.5.
Plus, get fresh news and smart talk on
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Do you know a fisher who braves the seas every day, bringing home a catch that feeds our communities? Nominate them now for the Anchor Awards, a night dedicated to celebrating the unsung heroes of our waters. On November 16th at the Bahama Resort, we're shining a spotlight on those who make waves, both big and small. Visit the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources Facebook page and click on the link provided to submit your nomination. Let's give our fishers the recognition they deserve. Anchor Awards 2024.
For fast, reliable, and impactful printing services, look no further. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life. We stand by our quality products that is second to none. Our affordable pricing and friendly, efficient staff makes Printmasters the ultimate choice for all your printing needs. We can deliver any type of printing services, from banners to booklets to business cards. You name it, we can print it.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 36.
It's time to explore your options. There's no harm in reviewing your mortgage arrangement and considering a better deal. CIBC Caribbean can help you narrow your search and decide. Switch your mortgage to CIBC Caribbean and enjoy a special interest rate and help towards your switching cost. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/inspired home for more information. Conditions apply.
CIBC, ambitions made real.
Maybe it's time to explore your options. There's no harm in reviewing your mortgage arrangement and considering a better deal. CIBC Caribbean can help you narrow your search and decide. Switch your mortgage to CIBC Caribbean and enjoy a special interest rate and help towards your switching cost. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/inspired home for more information. Conditions apply.
At Wendy's, we are different.
We don't just use beef.
It's fresh, never frozen. Our burgers are square because we never cut corners. Served hot off the grill with fresh lettuce, tomatoes, onions, and American cheese. We believe in fast food done right. Always serving fresh, never frozen beef. Order a hot, juicy Dave single, double, or triple. Made with fresh, never frozen beef. Now only at Wendy's. Different inside and out.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at Morning Blend 969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969. Text us 422-4796, 422-GR96. That's the BTC-powered Guardian Radio text line. And now at 8:22, it is time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams Paints. There's a severe weather warning in effect for East Grand Bahama and North Abaco and their keys and adjacent waters. That's in effect until 8:35 this morning. The Department of Meteorology says there is a cluster of heavy showers and embedded thunderstorms moving across this area, and that some of these showers will be locally heavy and thunderstorms strong to severe at times, causing strong gusty winds, dangerous lightning, heavy downpours, hail and waterspout or tornado activity. Again, that's in effect until 8:35 this morning. We'll see if that gets extended. But as we told you, there's a lot going on. We've got a mid to upper level trough continues to interact with abundant tropical moisture across the country, supporting bouts of unsettled weather over portions of the area through tonight. There remains an elevated risk for severe weather activity throughout the weekend, or continuing into the weekend, and heavy and prolonged rainfall may lead to flooding, especially in low-lying and flood-prone areas and already saturated areas. Additionally, motorists and all road users along coastal roadways need to be exercising caution, especially during high tide and minor coastal erosion. It's possible due to the presence of king tides over the rest of this week. And another hot day in store due to UV indices and heat indexes in the triple digits. Everyone's being advised to really exercise caution when outdoors and limit outdoor activities if you can. So for today, your forecast for the northern Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, partly cloudy to cloudy, 30. For the rest of the northwest Bahamas, including New Providence, cloudy. 30 to 50% chance of showers and thunderstorms again, especially in the afternoons. For the central Bahamas, variably cloudy, and for the southeast Bahamas, a mix of sun and clouds today, partly cloudy tonight. Temperatures getting up into the upper 80s for highs for the northern and northwest Bahamas. And that's a result of the cloud cover we're expecting today. And for the central and southeast Bahamas, in the low 90s. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 77 Fahrenheit, 25 Celsius, to about 79 Fahrenheit, 26 Celsius. The heat index, though, will make it feel like it's about 100 degrees Fahrenheit, 40 Celsius. Your extended outlook, partly cloudy to cloudy conditions will continue from Friday through to at least Monday, with about a 30 to 50% chance, especially for Friday and Saturday. Chance for showers and thunderstorms. In the tropics, we're watching a couple of areas. We've got an area of disorganized showers and thunderstorms over the central tropical Atlantic associated with remnants of Gordon. The system has a medium chance, about 40% chance of formation through the next 7 days. No impacts for us, though. And shower and thunderstorm activity has increased with a well-defined area of low pressure a few hundred miles to the northwest of Gordon, the remnants of Gordon. That system has a low chance, a 20% chance of formation through the next 7 days. And there's also broad area of low pressure that could form late this weekend or early next week over the western and northwestern Caribbean Sea. That system has a medium chance, about 40% chance for formation during the next 7 days. So we'll keep an eye on the tropics for you. That's your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams Paints. It's covered for all your painting and equipment needs. Visit Sherwin-Williams Paints online or in-store today. And time for another check of your traffic, brought to you by RBC. Find your loan solution with RBC. So with Gladstone Road, things are looking much better there now. Seeing not much to talk about there. And the traffic, though, has backed up a bit on John F. Kennedy Drive, especially westbound. If you're coming off Harold Road or Prospect Ridge Road near Theodore Lane, you're going to be seeing that slow-moving traffic westbound and a bit of congestion eastbound along Lake Cunningham towards a roundabout with Gladstone and Bahama Boulevard. Elsewhere, Milo Butler Highway, still very heavy for you from the Fire Trail roundabout straight up to Tawny Gwilym Sterling Highway. If you're heading northbound, traffic is backed up a bit along Tawny Gwilym Sterling Highway as well, eastbound toward that roundabout. And a bit further east as you are heading towards the roundabout with Bahamas Games Boulevard, especially if you're heading westbound. Back to Milo Butler Highway, you're going to see heavy traffic on the way to the six-legged roundabout. And that roundabout is going to be giving you issues right now if you're coming from JFK Drive eastbound, southbound on your Providence Highway, southwestbound on Farrington Road, and as you exit onto Thompson Boulevard, University Drive as well. University Drive looking busy for you near Big Pond Highway. Or University, on the way to Poinsana Drive. Independence Drive, both directions, heavy traffic for you, east and westbound. And Robinson Road, slow-moving traffic for you just west of Soldier Road. Eastern Road, still busy, westbound. And Prince Charles Drive at the major intersection. So good luck to you. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC. Start a conversation at rbc.com/loan/all of you.
If it's a new product come in the store, we walk the store and study that product.
One thing with our boss, if a new product comes in, he takes the time and he's always keeping us up to date with product knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And we just had 9 weeks of different products that we had to study, and we had exams at the end of each product.
Yeah.
The only way we could sell the product effective, we have to know that product. Yeah, that helps us to relate to our customers. It gives us better knowledge to know what product to introduce to them. You understand? So we can know what product to give them to use and what product not to give them to use.
Mm-hmm.
So product knowledge is really key in Sherwin-Williams.
They got the keys, and the key is the product knowledge that comes with our extensive product range at Sherwin-Williams Paints, Bahamas. Find color in every day.
Are you seeking exceptional health care beyond the traditional hospital setting? Introducing Doctors Hospital Clinics, your trusted destination for comprehensive care. Our full-service locations provide affordable services through our Loyalty Advantage membership program and NHI.
Experience seamless care with our integrated health system, where your medical history care. Book an appointment today at clinics.doctorshosp.com. We make primary care easy.
Craving something delicious and freshly made? Dunkin' has got you covered all day your way. From savory sausage, egg and cheese to crispy bacon, ham, and even tuna. Our sandwiches are made to order just for you. Choose your favorite. Bagels, croissant, toast, or muffin. Whatever you want, we've got it. Whether it's a classic grilled cheese or a hearty club, your perfect sandwich is just a bite away. Dunkin's fresh, made-to-order sandwiches, made all day, every day, only at Dunkin'. The Bahamas runs on Dunkin'.
Are you ready to be inspired? Get ready for the events of the year. Inspire Her 2024 is back and better than ever. Join us at the luxurious Atlantis Hotel Paradise Island on October 10th for an evening filled with inspiration, empowerment, and connection. Hear from leading women activists, entrepreneurs, CEOs, and more as they share their stories, insights, and wisdom. Get tickets now in the Alive Events app. Corporate packages and vendor opportunities are also available. Inspire Her 2024 Women's Conference, October 10th. See you there.
RBC. RBC will find the right loan for all of you with competitive rates and extended terms to suit you. Whether it's for debt consolidation, your next vehicle or home purchase, sometimes we all need a little more. No matter the reason for the loan, we're here to help you find the solution. RBC. RBC has all the loans for all of you. Let's start with a conversation today.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
My baby born in Birkin. She's been telling me all night long. Gasoline and groceries, the list goes on and on. It's 9 to 5, ain't working. Why the hell do I work so hard? I can't worry about my problems. I can't take them when I'm gone. Here comes the two.
We're back with Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn along with Laverne Gardner on this Thursday. We are going through the news, talking about a lot of the stories. They're making headlines this week. So we've been dealing with BPL, what the Managers Union is saying. They're concerned about their future with the Bahamas Grid, the deal with Pike and Island Grid. And what exactly is happening? Lots of questions, lots of questions. We got your text message to get to, and we want to get to so much more. We want to talk about this coroner's inquest and the officers involved, and mention the bridge authority bill and the Valley Wars. Yeah, back to that too. All of that today. Let's see if we can get through it. All right, so let's get to the text, Laverne. I've been asking my producers about this as well. When last have you all heard from Brayman? Oh boy. We have not heard Brayman call in for a while. Brayman, I hope you're okay. I hope he's okay. No? Boy. And then I noticed.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, right? So hope everything's okay, Brayman. This, my paper guy. I haven't seen him for a few days on Prince Charles Drive by Fox Hill. I haven't seen him. And I said, oh boy, I don't like that. I don't like that. I haven't seen him. He's in the papers today.
Oh.
Jetson Charles Gilcott, 61. Boy, nice guy. May his soul rest in peace. Okay, so, hey, your text messages. Get to these. This person says here, Dwight and Laverne, how can two different unions have two different views, yet the situation remains the same? No one has seen the documents on this BPL deal yet, but one is happy now all of a sudden, but one is still in the dark. Sounds like one of them union bosses. No, anyway. But, I mean, they're happy now. They weren't always happy, and I don't know how long they're going to be happy, but they felt a little more comfortable, they were saying, based on their recent conversation with the minister. Just a few days before that, they were the ones making the most noise about how they feel literally left out in the dark. So that could change at any minute. And maybe it'll change for the managers as well. Maybe somebody will say something and like, okay, well, that that gives me a little more comfort. Maybe, maybe. Another one concerned about the other union and what's happened there. This texter says, you did not mention that Pike has been handed $80 million of the $100 million raised in the name of the paying people and not one explanation for what they are being paid for or why an investor has been handed such a large sum of money. Well, that was the raising of the money they did a few weeks ago.
Do you think we'll ever... I don't know if this is like slow drying ink or whatever. Do you think we're going to ever get the detail, like the full detail?
Do we ever? That's all I can say. Do we ever?
Right.
But it is interesting.
Are the full details ever going to be laid out before us, or are we going to find out these things as time happens?
It is curious that this hasn't been in the House yet. I don't understand. Maybe things are still being worked on, but what is Pike doing here? Again, is it a different project? Is that unrelated to the big deal? And why isn't anybody saying? Did I miss it? Did you miss it? What's going on?
Yeah.
All of us missed it. This one says here, this is one big mix-up. How could the other union president, Kyle Wilson, say that he understands this mess without any final details? And they still have not filed in the public House of Assembly or the unions on what's going on. Very confusing. How could the minister feel comfortable after months of silence? Well, you mean, how can we feel? The ministers obviously always feel comfortable with about everything that they're doing. Must be. But the rest of us, that's the thing, yeah. This person says here, the union asked, why limit it to a one-year window when the company has a 25-year agreement and she's going to parrot the definition of what is going on rather than answer the question? Man, from now on, throw away all these word salad people who think talking long is also talking smart. I don't know about them classes, the F&M and the POP parties go... What? Got no shortage of eloquent but vapid speakers. Watch the parrots. Look that word up now. I think we know what a parrot is. You mean watch them look up what vapid means. Okay, I see what you're saying. Same ones all about Colin everything demure. Don't stop Beetlejuicing that word. Come on, we don't want to hear that. Oh, no. Starting a union is not easy. Ask Cable Bahamas all these years later. As many companies you could ask. Many, 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 much closer than Cable. Anyway. of trouble today. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning. How are you doing?
Doing well.
I personally think the government's playing a dangerous game because I feel as if they think Bahamians are passive, ignorant, stupid, dumb, and basically just don't care. And yes, many are. But it's like people get, like, you can only beat a horse for so long before the horse kicks you and, you know what I mean, reacts.
Or dies.
Yeah, it's like Menace promised a whole bunch of stuff. People believed in him, they voted him in, and then he talked foolishness about, oh, if you vote me in again, I'll do that. I mean, Brea promised a bunch of stuff. He's going to be the most transparent administration ever, and all these different things, and now it's like they're the complete reverse. They're the most secret administration. They say things they campaigned on and promised isn't a priority, like Freedom of Information Act, campaign finance reform. It's like they just don't take the Bahamian people seriously. And why they tell things get to the level of other countries where you have citizens taking matters in their own hands because they are so frustrated that the government isn't taking them seriously. Why wait till they get to that? It baffles my mind why our politicians... It's like, I'll give you an example, right? You have certain media personnel held rigged minutes over the coals for the foolishness he did, and people supported it. And all of a sudden, when minutes got voted out and the PRP got voted in, they were creased up underneath the PLP because they got a general manager job or they got a some kind of contract. It's like they quiet all of a sudden. And this was all for a bowl of porridge. And I've always remembered the saying that, what's good to gain the world and lose your soul? And that's what's missing in this country. People sell their soul for a dollar. It's about the betterment of the country. Brave Davis knows what needs to be done. Do right by the people. Forget the money sometimes. Do right by the people.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. All right. This texter says, how will we provide power for Bahamar's new hotel? Will we cut off the power in the east?
Well,
I don't know. You had to mention the east. But probably permanent load shedding. That's just how it'll be. This person says here, I honestly don't mind those Pike trucks because at least those guys are actually working. What now? I remember many times passing BPL workers as they just sit around and waste time. I don't feel bad for BPL workers. Time to go. Wow. Who sent this text? Oh, my God.
Well, where do you pass
Lord,
them?
Mercy. I mean, yes. Yeah, seriously, what are you talking them? About? I mean, they do have a lot of people that they're when they're working. But, I mean, huh? Everybody can't be up on the pole at the same time. Oh boy. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Morning, Dwight. Morning, LeBron. GNN again.
Good morning.
It's time for another update on the from the GNN, eh?
Right. I just listened to how passive and how insane the Bahamian people are, like that last texter. Like that last texter. Can't they see the handwriting on the wall? Meaning tickled you fasten. You have been found wanting. I mean, they're sitting down, uneducated. That's why they changed this from A, B, down to D, E, and F. This is by design to make a statement like that. Cable Bahamas was the same thing. There was a time when the road was flooded with Bahamians in Cable Bahamas trucks. You know why? Because Cable Bahamas, the private company, used the Bahamians to put in that necessary infrastructure. Now, see if you could find one with a Cable Bahamas truck on the road. BTC was the same thing. I was a product of that. We went all around the Family Islands prior to the sale of BTC, changing all of the power plants, doing all the heavy lifting, thinking we going to do some upgrades. When you look, they send us home. The new man coming with the computer, sit down, hook it up to the infrastructure we put in, all the BTC workers gone. What in the hell they think the Pike truck's doing out there? The man, spell it out for us. We could take over the T&D. We could upgrade that. What they think the Pike truck's doing. That's why they could transfer most of the Bahamians, like they did with BPL and BTC and Cable Bahamas, to help them put in the digital infrastructure with the Pike trucks, the new infrastructure, and then they could send them home. They're going to bust that union. Let everybody transfer over to help with that, and then they can send those workers home. Because if they take it over, the T&D, like somebody asked a question earlier, what is the Bahamians going to do when time to transfer back to BPL? Go as a security guard or go trim the yard? Come on, Bahamians. Come on, learn to be critical thinkers. This has happened to us before. Right, LeBron, thanks for taking my call.
Appreciate it. Wow. This texter says, this is so disheartening to hear of the union busting tactics that's happening. I really thought better of this administration. They always seem to be union friendly. This is deep. Well, I mean, we're just speculating here. It's not clear what's going on. And everybody's seeking answers, including the unions. This person says here, why do we keep putting these same two parties in power, FNM and PLP in power? They continue to do is sell our utility companies. This is absurd. This person says here, the light was on in half of my house yesterday. Good news, the AC was on, but the fridge was off. Okay, that's a big problem.
Hope
you have that resolved, and that might be specific to you or just your street. So that is not good. If you're AC, don't get relaxed because the
AC
was on.
Don't get excited. Don't be like, okay, at least I have AC.
Major problem. My goodness. Anyway, Dwight LaRoy, while not accusing the minister of anything, from her answers, it almost sounds like she has... I don't want to read this. Anyway, oh boy. Her answers are so vague and nonchalant. To me, it looks like she's... I can't. You're suggesting some serious things. I'm not going to read the rest of that. Okay. Why? There was a thunderstorm on Grand Bahama on Saturday, September 14th, and we were watching as the power stayed on in Hudson Estates. Ask the residents. What are you saying? The power stayed on. Okay, so that's great. That's a miracle. That's what you're saying.
Yes, that is a miracle.
Okay. Well, joy.
That's a miracle that there was a thunderstorm and the power stayed on.
Good stuff.
That's how we live in now, right? That would be considered a miracle.
Oh my Lord. I'm often amused at the level of rationalization and justification that Anton brings. Paging Anton. Anton, if you're listening, please call before I have to leave the car. And I, too, would like to know how the benefits and unionization of the BGC staff will be addressed. When I hear the Minister of National Security speak about the police-involved shootings, I think about election deniers in the USA. Mr. Prime Minister, don't run this man again. He will cost you. Whoa, okay. In just a moment. Let's take this text, this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Morning, Dwight.
Hi.
Morning, guys. How y'all doing?
Morning.
We need to be honest as Bahamians sometimes. And I think politics and politicians in this country for a long time use these corporations to put their supporters in and give jobs and these particular corporations run inefficient, pump a lot of money in these on salaries, same thing with the government sector and all that stuff. And they know, and because they're in power and they can see that it's bleeding these particular corporations dry. I think, right, Honorable Hubert Ingram, he had a time when he had to downsize a lot of these public corporations because he wanted to stave off the implementation of VAT. And Zedness was one of them. A lot of people went home. He had Zedness down to under 150 employees. Made it PBS, sell off a lot of the stuff, and now we back up to 300 some employees at Zedness. These unions have to be honest with some of these members. Yes, we put in a call of talk about putting in infrastructure. Yes, corporations do that. And then after you put in infrastructure, you don't need the amount of employees to run these particular corporations efficiently. Because it leads to heavy spending for expenses, and these people are here to make a profit, right? They're here to make a profit. They're based on what I've read, they're on performance based. If people would read what whatever would present it to us, they're on performance based. They get paid the percentage of the kilowatt hours that we pay. They get paid a percentage of that. And they're here for a timeline to fulfill whatever. So when they come in here, they're bringing their people who can perform along with the employees that we have here. They're not interested, and I can be honest with you, with this union foolishness, because they're here for performance. And the same thing would happen to BTC. And now, after everything now, you see a lot of Cable Bahamas, you see all of these, but they're just sourcing out these infrastructure jobs now. You don't see a bunch of trucks with Cable Bahamas employees. These are private contractors on the street.
Yeah.
Putting up overhead cables and stuff.
With both the telecoms companies. Yeah. Private contractors.
And this, we want to sit in this country and feel like, I had my job for 20 years. Yes, yeah, you had 20 years on the job, but times have changed. Nobody's using telephones in their homes anymore. So I don't need 100 employees no more because everybody's on fiber optics now. So it what took 10 employees might need to take one. So it's evolving, Dwight, and Bahamian people. You could run and behind the union all you want, and unions needs to be honest with their membership, man. Evolve with the times. Now, the government, on the other hand, because they need Bahamians for votes, need to be honest with the Bahamian people, put that deal on the table and say, what is what? You know that based on the unions and BPL, we cannot sustain an effective electricity in the country.
based on the amount of employees and the amount of salaries you're paying these people, and the lack of resources you have to bring a deal in here. Be upfront with the deal, man. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
And we might respect you for whatever deal it is. The deal seems shady, Dwight. It's shady, and we're going into a deal with a foreign company and with a local company, to be honest. And it's not transparent.
Mm-hmm. Thanks so much. Yep, well said. Thank you. Take that call. Yeah, good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, guys. How are you this morning?
Doing well.
Morning. My honest opinion, Dwight, on Laverne. What I've seen on the road in the last several weeks with this company, Pike, to me personally, they're doing an excellent job. Because guess what? You're there noticeable, working, okay? And to my amazement.
What are they working on?
Pardon me?
What are they working on?
They're working on the lines. They're working on the pole, changing poles, lines, all of that on the streets.
Mm-hmm. Your power hasn't gone off recently?
Pardon me?
Your power hasn't gone off recently?
Yes, power been going off and on. What do you expect if you're changing poles? Do you think the power's going to stay on?
That's why it's going off.
What I'm saying to you, Dwight, is this the same union members and union that walked through with the minister less than 2 weeks ago and agreed with the minister?
No, are these different people? This is the managerial union.
Yes, you're trying to tell me the minister came down to BPL and didn't even consult with the managerial union? That's what you're saying to me?
No, that's not what we're saying. She answered the questions.
At the end of the day, right, we are complaining about electricity being too high and costly, but she's trying her best to try to have it fixed, right? Yes, I think a little bit more details need to be forthcoming, but it'll take time for that to happen, Dwight.
Take time for details?
You can't have a cake and one ice cream to go along.
They want just details. Why would it take a little more time for them?
Yes, they'll get the answers. Most definitely. Let's get the grab
the answers. You have to wait until everything is in motion to get the answers, especially the answers impact you.
Doing an excellent job.
How can you say...
The authority is agreeing with the power company... increase your rate.
We just want to know where you get your excellent job critique from. I mean, just because you see them, that means they're doing an excellent job.
No. I get my excellent job critique by asking questions, stopping on the side of the road and ask them what they're doing, okay? They're changing power lines, upgrading power lines, changing lamp poles, doing all of that, okay? All right? That's where I get my excellent critique from.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, guys.
Okay.
Maybe
the union should stop and ask them on the street too for the answers. Consider that managerial union. Go talk to the Pike guys and see. Maybe you'll get your answers since you're not getting.
Right.
Since the minister is confusing you.
Whether you agree with unions or you have an issue with unions or not, the union is in place. And so they are trying to understand and they may have been there through the walkthrough. And based on the walkthrough, they had more questions. And so they are now trying to understand exactly what's going to happen to their employees. The caller prior to this, he had some excellent points. Times have changed. And certainly we're not doing things the way that we used to do it, where we will require the same amount of employees. But even that is a conversation to have with your union. That you come to the table and say, this is where we're at as a company. And as we're improving, there are going to be some changes around here. We're going to be more efficient. But even in that, let's see how we could create these exit strategies, these packages. Yes, some people won't be happy. But you need to be able to have these conversations so that we don't have the issues that we're having now, so that we don't have managers unions and other unions saying that things are happening and we don't know what's going on. Employees are asking, what is this going to look like for me? If everybody is going to Bahamas Grid, but they're still saying that BPL is going to exist, where does that leave me?
Yeah.
Those are questions. Those are reasonable questions. Mm.
It must be, is it fun? Is it enjoyable to be, you know, drinking the Kool-Aid or wearing those colored glasses where you see everything looking perfect? Yeah, I don't know, Laverne. Maybe we should try some. Everything will be great. Like, it's excellent. It's an excellent job. They're doing fantastic. Everything's perfect. Like, I mean,
what I think we should.
I would like to be more positive.
Be Right. I think that what we should do is just be more objective. Just because you support a party doesn't mean that that party always gets it right, always does everything correctly. And we should be able to have these kinds of conversations because this is impacting people, right? Whether, regardless of whether they fall on the political divide, this is affecting people and there is a genuine concern. Nobody was criticizing Pike saying that they're not doing an excellent job. I think Dwight was saying he doesn't know what they're doing. So he's unable to say whether they're doing an excellent job or not.
Exactly. I hope they are. I hope they're doing an excellent job.
I'm going to say to you, when you leave Guardian today,
if talk to a Pike worker. Shop. Oh, I will.
Exactly.
I can't help but see
exactly.
them. Right. I mean, I'm surprised that there's not one in my house. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning. I'm Dwight. And
morning.
How's everything going?
We're doing well.
Yeah, I think the last caller is confoolish, meaning that he's stuck between confused and being foolish because what he says makes no sense at all. What is wrong with the minister tabling? What's going on with BPN? I don't understand why we can't get it at this point, and this has been going on from June.
We're all
wondering. How can you feel comfortable with something that you don't know what's going to happen? You don't know the details. So it's really just foolishness what he's running on with. So you just got to flag down the people you see on the side of the road and ask them what's going on? Is that how we do it?
Yes.
That sounds like a great plan. They won't be getting any work done because there's going to be a bunch of people asking them questions.
You all enjoy your day, though, but we have to get serious as a country. This is, by this time now, the minister should have tabled something to the country to let us know exactly what's in the plan for BPF.
Yeah. All right. I mean, we've seen a very basic plan, but people just want to know how this is going to be executed and why hasn't it gone through the houses yet. Okay, some more calls before we have to break for the news. Good morning, caller, you're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Laverne.
Hi.
Good morning.
Listen, as far as from the information that came out that I viewed yesterday on the TV concerning this BPL Pike and all of this stuff, the explanations given by the minister left more questions than answers. You know, it seems to be that a lot of this stuff is conflicting and confusing. And for a person who can dissect and analyze things, to have a person like that confused with the information that was distributed, I mean, heaven help the person who does not have an analytical mind, who cannot break things down. Where do you leave them? You leave them confounded. So, again, there are more questions than answers that was given. For the caller who talked about unions, let me tell you something. You may not think that the unions aren't important, but we still have a good level of victimization and intimidation. We have a lot of Bahamians' rights that have been eroded by governmental moves and even private sector moves. And unions are very much essential and important in this town today. And, you know, to try and dismiss or downplay them is a travesty. They are important. They may not be important to you, I can tell you. I've been a unionist for over 30 years, even though I didn't really have to call on them because once you know the rules or regulations of the company that you work for and the confines and so on and so forth, you don't depend on them much. But to those workers whose rights are being stepped and trampled upon on a daily basis, the union is there to protect them. That's why they're there. So do not downplay unions. You know, it's sad when I hear people talk about union busting and all that stuff. It hurts me because just because you don't go through it, you haven't gone through it, does not mean that unions aren't important. My last point here before I go, Dwight.
Yes.
You know, it's really amusing to see that we as learned Bahamians, we are treated as if we are dumb and stupid. We see what's going on in the country, and it isn't about party colors or affiliations. It's all about we as Bahamians not getting the true level of service and justice in this deserve. We have to fight now for these things. And if we continue to sit down and allow these people just to smooth anything over you, then guess what? We will continue getting what we're getting with no positive results.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Before we go, this text here, just turn it on just a little bit so everyone can hear this. They say, Dwight, there is no gold-colored Kool-Aid. If you see gold liquid, don't drink it. It's probably something you shouldn't drink. Oh, dear. So it's like urine. Oh, boy. That sounds about right.
Oh,
that makes a lot of sense. We'll be back. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Regarding any tumor, Bahamas. Fishing in Long Island, Bahamas. Sailing on the river, Bahamas. Diving, pumpkin, resting, Bahamas. Season, rice, and fried fish, Bahamas. Pineapple, tomato, Bahamas.
Mango Fisher, who braves the seas every day, bringing home a catch that feeds our communities, nominate them now for the Anchor Awards, a night dedicated to celebrating the unsung heroes of our waters. On November 16th at the Bahama Resort, we're shining a spotlight on those who make waves, both big and small. Visit the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources Facebook page and click on the link provided to submit your nomination. Let's give our fishers the recognition they deserve. Anchor Awards 2024.
Ready to save? You can put $100 into the CFAL Savings Express plan and make sure your money keeps growing. Earn interest on your savings while you're sleeping at the bank. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL. Growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Are you tired of the same old 5K runs? Want something more? Then get ready for the Chickchawney Challenge City Run on September 28th, starting at Crypto Wild. Test your strength, stamina, and spirit. It takes all of you to dodge, climb, conquer obstacles as you race through the heart of the city. Lace up and get to the Chickchawney Challenge City Run. Register now on our website, chickchawneychurn.com, or on our social media pages. Brought to you by Kalina, Island Yogurt, Advantage Insurance, Art of Growth, and Guardian Radio 96.9.
Bahamas, are you ready?
Keep the Vibe Alive Music Group, along with Alpha Sounds, presents
the best of the best, Raking, Scrape, Explosion, Reloaded.
This is the biggest one-day all Bahamian concert of the year.
Featuring KB, D-Mac, Abby,
Mama D,
Fan Sean,
Shine, 242,
The Falcons,
and more.
Mark your calendars. It's going down November the 2nd
at Super Club Breezes Ground.
Tickets now available at BahamasEtickets.com
or both Beauty Shack location.
General admission $60. VIP Skybox and Skypods also available.
For more info, call 394-0819
or email keepthevibealive242 at gmail.com.
Experience the magic once again
with more legends for one night only.
Come
party with us November 2nd at Best of the Mass.
Raking, Scrape, Explosion, Reloaded. Rescue me.
All those loans I had were so overwhelming. Fidelity's debt consolidation loan combined all my loan payments into one easy payment with a built-in savings plan that pays me unbeatable interest. It's time to make that move to Fidelity. Call 356-77 to
Fidelity. We're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is the Guardian News Network update on the hour. Hello, everyone. I'm Charlene Ferguson. Bahama officials estimate some 400 construction jobs will be created when they begin work on their new $350 million hotel at the Old Malia Resort site. During the signing of that heads of agreement yesterday, Bahama President Graham Davis said they hope to start on requests for proposals for that construction work in early 2025 and get shovels in the ground in early 2026. He expects it will take 3 years to completely finish the project and host their first guests at a hotel which he predicts will create 500 full-time jobs. Arrest warrants have been issued for three police officers who failed to appear as ordered before coroner Kara Turnquest-DeVoe yesterday. They and 11 other police officers were found responsible for the unlawful killings of various suspects in separate police-involved shootings. The 11 officers who did appear in court were granted $9,500 bail and ordered to return to court September 25th to learn whether the Director of Public Prosecutions will act on those homicide by manslaughter verdicts by coroner's juries. And the Grand Bahama Port Authority has launched a 45-day public consultation period to gather feedback from residents and stakeholders there on that proposed 6.3% increase to the base rate of electricity for customers of the Grand Bahama Power Company. When that consultation period ends November 4th, the GBPA says its regulatory team and regulatory consultant will thoroughly review the proposed application and public feedback to determine what is reasonable for customers at this time before issuing a final decision on that rate application on December 2nd. Both government and opposition leaders oppose that rate hike. That's what's making headlines at this hour. Stay with us. AP Update.
Do you know someone who is a champion for peace, a person who embodies and encourages cooperation, mutual respect and justice, and creates a safe environment in which everyone can flourish? Well, guess what? You have from now until September 30th to visit our website, CharacterDayBahamas.org, and nominate that special person for a chance to be honored as a hidden hero.
When you jump in your Japanese import and you turn the radio on, all you hear is... For the month of September, the HitSpot will install a band extender in your Japanese import for the discounted rate of only $79.99, VAT included. Get your band expander installed today at the HitSpot and listen to... Plus, get fresh news and smart talk on
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm Rita Foley with an AP News Minute. The number of Americans applying for unemployment fell last week to its lowest level in 4 months. And there's good news for consumers. The Fed is cutting its key interest rate by a half point. But Chair Jerome Powell is pushing back against any suggestion that it shouldn't act this close to a presidential election. The AP's Sagar Magani.
Donald Trump has argued lowering rates now amounts to political interference. But for Powell...
This is my fourth presidential election at the Fed.
And nothing changes.
We're always going into this meeting in particular and asking what's the right thing to do for the people we serve.
Powell says that's it, serving the people, not any politician or cause or issue.
It's never about anything else. Nothing else is discussed.
Sagar Magani.
The price of gas is up a penny in the past day to $3.22 a gallon, says the AAA. I'm Rita Foley.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Thursday, September 19th, 2024. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn along with Laverne Gardner. And as we were telling you in Morning Blend, hey, we've been stood up by our scheduled guests. So it's just me and Laverne talking about what's in the news. And there's a lot of business news to talk about, including the state of bridges in the country, the Bridge Authority bill passing in the House, the MPs trying to ensure proper management of bridges throughout the country. We're going to get into that in just a bit. And we've got the latest on Junkanoo with the Valley Boys, both of them, what they're saying in response to what the JCNP is saying about what's going to be happening on Boxing and New Year's Day. So all of that is coming up, Laverne. But I do want to get to this really quickly. this court and what happened yesterday with the summonses for 13 or 14 officers, and where things stand at this point. Artiza Davis writing about it. Coroner Kara Turnquest DeVoe on Wednesday granted bail to 11 policemen whom jurors found unlawfully killed suspects during police-involved shootings, and the coroner is now ordering these officers to return to court on September 25th. Right? That's when the officers will learn whether the Director of Public Prosecutions will act on the homicide by manslaughter verdicts of the coroner's juries. The verdict of a coroner's jury is advisory and doesn't determine whether criminal or civil liability, whether there is any. One of the officers, Constable Kevin Greenslade Jr., already has a pending trial in the Supreme Court stemming from the 2021 fatal police shooting of Danrico Carey in Nassau Village. Laverne, are you on?
Yes, I am.
Okay, great. Just making sure.
Yeah, I'm listening.
Okay. He's accused of causing dangerous harm to Carey while three other policemen are charged with his murder. An inquest was not held into Carey's death. Jurors returned a verdict of homicide by manslaughter against Greenslade and 3725 Young, not sure of the first name there, in the death of Shanton Forbes. Greenslade, Young, Inspector Akeem Wilson, who was the interested party in two inquests, 3859 Stirrup, Inspector H. Curtis, 3096 Wright. I wish the police would just give people's first names. Anyway, 2825 Sweeting, 3039 Johnson, 3726 Roll, 3350 had their bail set at $9,500. Homicide by manslaughter verdicts were returned following inquests into the deaths of D'Angelo Evans, Shanton Monroe, Azario Major, Harold Brown, Richard Bastian, Ernest Forrest, and Elroy Stubbs. Meanwhile, the coroner issued arrest warrants for three policemen who failed to appear yesterday. The inquest into the 2022 shooting death of Valentino Johnson was held in the absence of Constable Shando King and Samuel Ferguson. King was fired from the police force after he was accused of attempted murder and firearms charges. The marshal, Angela Whitfield, said that Ferguson had previously submitted a sick slip but was unsure of his status now. A warrant was also issued for Officer 3139 DeVoe after he failed to appear in court. No explanation was provided for his absence. DeVoe is an interested party in the May 23rd, 2017 shooting death of 15-year-old Gino Finley Jr. Wow. Well, meanwhile, what was that?
I'm just amazed at all of this. Mm-hmm. 9 times bail?
Say that last part again. Breaking up.
How much was the bail?
9,500. Yes.
Each of them?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now, so while this is happening, some officers apparently have petitioned Minister of National Security Wayne Monroe for help, asking to be removed from frontline duty since several policemen have been appearing in the coroner's court for inquests involving police-involved shootings. Right. Hmm. Monroe made his comments to reporters when asked about what's happening with the coroner's court and the issuing of the summonses for the 14 policemen to appear. Coroner's juries returned verdicts by homicide for the 14 officers. Yesterday, Monroe, a former criminal defense attorney, said that while the legal process plays out, the public should not rush to judgment in any of the cases.
Come on, Dwight. We're going to fall out. We're full out rushing to judgment.
Who's we?
This is what
Who's
we do.
We?
I'm
not on that highway with y'all. Monroe told reporters outside the house, quote, "The one thing that the public should not do is equate the fact that this has happened with the guilt of these officers." That would be against the process. There are some challenges that as minister I've been confronted with since all of this has happened. There have been officers who have been asking me to intervene to remove them from frontline duty. I don't run the police force, so I can't help them. But at the end of the day, it is something that we must all be mindful of. There is a process, and we respect the process. The summons is corrected in oversight by the coroner, who failed to inform the officers that they would be committed to the Supreme Court when the verdicts were delivered in compliance with the Coroner's Act. One of the officers, Inspector Aaron Wilson, was part of three police-involved shootings. One, two, three. Three. The officers were expected to appear before the coroner on Monday, but none of them. How is it three? How? Like three different ones or three people in one incident? What? Anyway, three? What the heck? Three? The officers were expected to appear before the coroner on Monday, but none of them appeared, prompting Turnquest DeVoe to issue arrest warrants for them. However, the coroner rescinded the arrest. Monroe, who represents several of the officers involved, said his clients had not received the summonses. Several of the officers appeared in coroner's court yesterday for a criminal committal, hearing, and were later granted bail. Asked about the situation yesterday morning, Monroe said what's happening is all part of the legal process. He said, quote, "We are governed by laws. The rules are there. If the rules aren't fit for the purpose or offend the Constitution, we will change them. But until then, you follow the rules. The rules are that the coroner has certain obligations, which I gather that she is now purporting to carry out. The family of deceased persons have rights under the Coroner's Act to be in court. The persons who may be affected, like the police officers, have rights too. So the system is there where everyone has the ability to put their case forward, then the chips fall where they may. The matter is adjudicated and the courts will make a determination." He added that the Royal Bahamas Police Force has a history of bringing officers to account if wrongdoing is suspected, saying, quote, "There are a number of officers who have been charged by the police force for homicide in the Family Islands and a number here in New Providence. The law is the law. If there is an allegation, it's put before the court and the court determines it. The one thing the public should be very mindful of is they can see that the police have charged their own. They can see that with other persons who the police have not charged, and there is some process that says they must be brought to account. That happens." Okay. Okay. Interesting. Explain to me. I'm not sure I'm getting it. So the officers who wanted to be removed from frontline duty. This is while the matter is going on. This is because what? It's uncomfortable dealing with the public when they are. Issues? Or what do you make of that? What am I missing? Do you get it, Laverne? You're muted.
Oh, sorry.
Now
I was on mute.
Yeah.
Yeah. I am thinking that, well, here are a couple of scenarios. I don't know. Maybe they're saying remove us because we don't want, in the event that something happens and we have to discharge our weapon, and God forbid, we've killed someone.
Again.
We will also be facing charges.
Oh, maybe other officers, not the ones who are in. Okay.
That's what I understood it to mean. That other officers are reaching out and saying, hey, we don't want to find ourselves in this position.
Officers who are not in any issues, who are not facing issues now, but
who
are
not
that
currently
they could
facing
be.
Any issues. Ah. That is what I interpreted.
Okay. All right. Well, that makes
right,
more
that
sense.
Those they're asking then to be removed so that this doesn't happen.
So what you want to do? Just work.
Officers
to duty?
Who maybe, or maybe there are officers who maybe they feel like something they did is going to be under review. So move me, please. I don't know, but I'm thinking the first is what it is.
I need to join the fire department then, huh? Or the band. We love the band, though. We love the band.
We absolutely
I
do.
I don't understand. Anyway, good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Mr. Strawn.
Hi.
Good morning, Laverne.
Good morning.
Mr. Strawn.
Mm-hmm.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, I had a conversation with you the other morning, and I had used the term murder, but, you know, the only difference between a homicide and murder is they say one is intentional, right? Right? So, if someone is an officer,
well, no. Well, if you manslaughter might not be intentional.
I know, but I was looking at the definition. I actually went and looked at the definition. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying is, if you're an officer, what they're saying to me is you cannot contrive anything. But I can understand why some of the officers now don't want to be in the, on the front lines. But what I'm perplexed about is these problems that they encounter can be solved by them wearing body cams and putting in dash cams to show the scenario.
Yes.
So it can be documented. So without that, then you leave the onus on the citizens to prove whatever accusations you have against an officer. So then that leaves us in a situation whereby, let's say you were injured by an officer during a search warrant, in which, all right, Mr. Mundo said, do not rush to judgment. But may I remind the public that the police officers rush to judgment when somebody calls and gives information on someone. Mm-hmm. And they rush to judgment by saying it's gospel. They never go and do any research on the person and say if this is a violent offender or the chronology of historical records of a person before they come and do a search warrant or before they go and look for people. Even when the prisoner escaped, 3 o'clock, by 3:10, he has a gun in his hand. He's armed and dangerous. So we have a scenario in which they always have the upper hand. And so we see even the leniency with the bails, et cetera, and how hard it is to prove against them. But why is it that just the cameras just can't be implemented so officers can feel safe and the public can feel safe? But we as citizens are all responsible for this because we have not acknowledged the problem. Scoogey every week letting you know that even from back in his days, officers were gang affiliated. We are a part of this problem and we're not looking for solutions. And so we as citizens must call for the upholding of the rule of law. And, you know, the police are doing a great job. Let's say with the guy who robbed the tourists and shoot gun all about down. I didn't even care if the police kill him. Because when you're doing them kind of acts, but you don't come around people who never have a history of these things and then beating them while they handcuffed and doing a number of things, and then when somebody says what they see, it becomes a problem. So then we as citizens are responsible because we have allowed for decades the police force to self-govern, right, themselves, without any repercussions. Let's say, normally with Mr. Greenslade, you had a surname of one of the officers. Mr. Greenslade, if he was in power, maybe Ferguson, somebody would have came out and gave a statement to the public, reassuring and then bringing out other cases of other insubordinations, a chronology of insubordinations by officers. So once the citizens are not active in protesting and demanding justice, then this will continue. And so the police force has been allowed to run away with itself and just feed us their gospels, as we saw with Azaria Major and a whole host of other cases. When the documentary was put out with a certain case, it was said that this guy was called back to this club. And, you know, what I'm saying is, right, can they ever be wrong? What I'm saying is, you saying that you are charging them is okay, but let's give some data and show what has happened since they're being charged, because this is like somebody running away with themselves and self-governing themselves. And when you call out for justice as a citizen, you become the victim and you become the problem. And that can't work.
Okay.
And it's been going on for decades. So for me, I hear people, but you have 14 police officers. Man, listen, these things don't surprise me. Now, you really think it's only 14 officers? You really think it's in the newspaper, in your Guardian, where the word headshot was engraved on a weapon that was police-owned? Now, they say it was a police-owned. But in any event, that's a government property. So why would the word headshot be governed? You have to understand, even I heard on your news, an officer is already implicated in 3 shootings. Why isn't he being pulled up the front line and psychoanalyzed and taken off the front line?
Exactly. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. That doesn't make any sense. Doesn't make sense. 3 times. Great points you're raising
three.
There.
You emphasize that.
I mean, I don't think the people on the force understand what 3 means. 3 different times? But you got to be afraid of every time he walks out the door. Like, oh, Lord. Yeah, I don't know if this is you texting this 52. Dwight, that's why they have body cams. They need to turn them on. It protects them and the public. Yeah, for those officers who are petitioning the National Security Minister, get him to agree to have body cams on everybody and have them on all the time. They're dealing with the public. Body cams, dash cams, all the cams in the interrogation room, wherever, have the cameras on. Record everything. That would solve a lot of issues. We'll take one more call on this, and then we need to move on. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning.
Hi, good morning. Turn on your radio for us, please.
Yeah, already did.
Morning.
Listen, what 52 is saying, I so agree with him, because at the end of the day, see, I feel like most of this is now coming out, and other stuff we're hearing will come out too because of what happened with the officer that was put on garden leave. And I feel like they know everybody's watching everything they do, because you have a lot more officers out there who from way back when who's been doing foolishness and have certain person that they go to for whatever information that they need, to the point of beating them. Because I had a friend at one point where they used the car battery and with the charging thingy, which is used when they're jumping out of cars, and stick it on his body and put it on the battery, just to get whatever information what he didn't have. So these officers have done a lot to people out there, and they are put back to work with these same people who are now afraid to say anything against them for fear of what their friends would do in retaliation. It's a lot of back and forth. And with the camera, the body cam, I think we need our MPs to now wear body cam so we can see what they're doing in the office.
What?
Our MPs. Not when they're having their thing in the cabinets and stuff. Now, I'm talking about when they're out and interacting and doing and have you guys with ZNS and all the other stations around the table with cameras to show when they're doing these deals.
So okay. We could hear so for in boardrooms.
Pardon?
Whenever they're boardrooms and stuff like that. Or
Whenever they're negotiating. I'm having broadcast live. No secret deal. So we could know why did you get Dwight on this contract.
Because then they'll...
He campaigned hard for you.
It's not going to work because they'll take it off when they're home, right? And that's exactly when they'll invite that person over for dinner. And then the secret deal will be made. So,
at least they'll know who got the contract.
You think so?
Just that part.
Okay. Interesting.
Thank you.
I don't think you want to see what they're doing with the... boy. That might be too much information. But I hear you. Interesting. Wow. Some more text messages on this. As you say, we're going to move on, though. This person says here, 3 times is something indicative, but the police will always give the benefit of the doubt. Can you imagine calling the police and no one comes? Imagine that. This texter is claiming that a certain person that caused us to all now know the term garden leave is no longer on garden leave and back on the force. Could that possibly be true? I mean, the investigation is continuing. So that, although we don't know because we're not getting regular updates.
Is it continuing?
I don't even really know if it began, but
exactly.
We were told.
So what we need to do now is to begin asking for an update.
But will you get an answer? Because you're not supposed to come to them with questions. They will tell us when they're ready to tell us something. So
I think if we keep asking, then we'll get some sort of a response. So I think that we, in media and the general public, we need to ask. We would like another update. Let's continue to ask and agitate for another update. We would like another update. Where do we stand in the investigation? Is this officer still on garden leave? I just started.
Okay.
So every day, Dwight,
you're gonna do
every
it.
Day, even whether I'm not on, make sure that you ask.
Okay. Okay. Sounds
good.
And
encourage all of the other media personalities to do the same.
Somebody saying it's true. It's true. Michael Pintard spoke about it at a press conference. What? And they're sending me a video from a scene. And are you sure this is recent? Oh my God. Seriously? Okay. Oh, boy. Seriously? So what? That's just it? Wow.
But, okay, Dwight. You know that we don't know what's happening, right?
No, I mean, it looks like it's true. There's,
I'm going to need you to use your words.
I don't know what to say. I'm stunned. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller on the air.
Good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
Good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
Good morning.
I just wanted to make 2 points. One on your earlier topic as relates to unions that was having at DPS and now pipe. And I see a lot of these pipe trucks around them. Don't necessarily know what they're doing. And I was seeing them change the pole, like one of the callers suggested. Like they're doing maintenance, where they're checking to see if things are in order. And I see 6-7 trucks around. And the same complaints used to have about BPL staff. Remember sometimes, well, the BC, do it BC then. You say 7 people hanging around, 2. But a lot of trucks around, for me, it's just a PR thing. But anyhow, Peter and me, I want to say to the unions, it's always important to put a clause in your industrial agreement that speaks to when these things are changing, there'll be no less favorable conditions. I think it's very important. I don't know if they have that in their clause, but they need to make sure that's a clause that they put in there. There'll be no less favorable conditions when the government is switching ownership as relates to these quasi-government agencies or the power company and the telephone company, those sort of things, right? And there's something I want to tell the general public. Being a part of a union is like buying health insurance or life insurance. You only be a part of a union in case you need them. When you pay for health insurance, you ain't praying to get sick, but in case you get sick, you won't have that. And when you pay for life insurance, you ain't praying to die, but just in case you die, it's there. So the union does have their role to play in protecting the rights of workers in our country, and unions really cause the country to be where it is today. So I wish people would, take a second look at unions and stop being so political about everything. The same people who be complaining about the unions, they don't know if it wasn't for the union, their party would have never got majority rule. They need to know that. And the workers of this country continuously support successive governments as they see fit. So okay. I thought I'd make that point.
Yep. Thanks a lot. Morning caller, you're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight, and thanks for taking my call. And good morning, Levine. How you doing over there in my hometown, Freeport, ma'am? How you doing, Levine?
Good morning.
Dwight.
She can hear you. Laverne, you might be muted
get
again.
On the mute button.
Okay, but go on. Hey. Mm-hmm. Yep.
I'm sorry. I was muted.
I like how she plays and speaks. And she's, sometimes I say she's a handful in a good way.
Okay, I'm sure.
Hi, Papa. Good morning. Sorry, my mic was muted.
Huh?
I said, sorry, my mic was muted. Good morning. How are you?
Everything cool, Mom. Thank God for life. We're right holding on. Hope things to get better in my hometown over there in Grand Bahama and Freeport, Mom.
Yeah.
I hope they can keep the light on. But, see, this is one of the reasons why I was saying maybe the commissioner of police need to be either be fired or resign. Not because he wasn't doing a good job in the past, because it starts with the top. And it seems like he don't have no respect for the media, neither us, the BMN people.
Mm-hmm.
If there's any truth that the person who make us know what garden leave mean is back to work, we should have known it's not what you do, it's how you do things, man. How they could do that like that? But I really ain't surprised, Because it's like we little favoritism in this country, Because your tires. Yeah, they're good people, we respect them and everything, but you make your family shame sometimes. Sometimes we do some dumbness in our life, and it's come out in public. See, ever since the lawyer was still able to go to court and do it like normal, and his voice sound like voice of a lawyer sound like it was on that recording saying that he ain't no Joneser, I say ain't nothing to come out of this, man. Nothing
can
come out of this.
Okay. Well, let's not give up hope yet. Thanks a lot, Popper. We're going to try to figure out what's going on. That would be very unusual and strange. But we're going to try to sort that out and see what is the truth. We got to take a break. When we come back, we've got a couple more issues to get to. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio, 96.9 Morning Blend Business. Stay tuned.
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL. Growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Nassau, get ready for a night you simply won't want to miss. For the first time in over 40 years, experience an evening with Eddie Menace live at the Amphitheater Nassau Cruiseport on Saturday, October 5th. Tickets are on sale now. Go to TicketBoxEvents.com or go to the box office located in the Junkanoo Museum. Joining Eddie on stage, Fran Chung, Gino D, Ira Storr, and the Higher Level Band. An evening with Eddie Menace live at the Amphitheater Nassau Cruiseport, Saturday, October 5th. Get your tickets now.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
It is time for your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL. Bahamar has experienced a slowdown in business heading into the fall season. That's going to the resort's president, Graham Davis. He told members of the media that it is likely the upcoming U.S. general election is partly to blame for the year-on-year drop in occupancies. Davis, who spoke to the media on the sidelines of the heads of agreement signing between Bahamar and the government for a $350 million hotel where the Melia Nassau Beach Resort once stood, said that forward bookings for next year, while strong, have not been pacing with the banner year of what we've seen previously. That was more than 9 million people visited the country. You can read more about his comments in today's Guardian Business section. The implementation of the qualified domestic minimum top-up tax for corporations earning more than 750 million euros per year will ease the burden of Bahamian taxpayers and eliminate budget deficits, Prime Minister Philip Davis telling attendees of the Association of International Banks and Trust Companies Nassau conference yesterday. When the government released the draft domestic minimum top-up tax bill 2024 last month for public consultation, it said the legislation would generate 140 million annually. The government said it in a release last month that it is a significant tax measure under the two-pillar solution agreed to by over 130 countries, including the Bahamas, and is part of the OECD G20 inclusive framework on base erosion and profit shifting. Executive Director of the Securities Commission of the Bahamas, Christina Rolls, says that there has been rising and persistent breaches by its registrants and licensees, which has led the SCB reviewing anti-money laundering, countering the financing of terrorism, and counter-proliferation fines. She says the Securities Commission will begin the enforcement of financial penalties for cited breaches by licensees. And Attorney General Ryan Pinder emphasizing the need for further innovation in the financial services sector, Pinder in his remarks at the AIBT conference yesterday, acknowledging all the hard work the sector has put in over the past several years to successfully court the Brazilian market with products like the investment condominium, known as Icon, and the Smart Fund, but said things have now changed. Overseas, overseas from the U.S., the International Brotherhood of Teamsters declining to endorse Kamala Harris or Donald Trump for president, saying neither candidate had sufficient support from the 1.3 million member union. Teamsters President Sean O'Brien in a statement saying, quote, neither major candidate was able to make serious commitments to our union to ensure the interests of working people are always put before big business. We sought commitments from both Trump and Harris not to interfere in critical union campaigns for core Teamsters industries and to honor our members' right to strike, but were unable to secure those pledges. The Teamsters rebuff, reflecting a labor union torn over issues of political identity and policy, one that mirrors a broader U.S. national divide. Vice President Harris has unmistakably backed organized labor, while former President Trump has appealed to many white, blue-collar workers, even as he has openly scorned unions at times. By not endorsing anyone, the Teamsters essentially ceding some influence in November's election, as both candidates claim to have support from its members. And as we told you late yesterday, the company behind Tupperware, the plastic kitchenware that revolutionized food storage after World War II and became linked to the parties where women securing a measure of financial independence and fun in mid-century America sold the colorful products. That company's now filed for bankruptcy. Tupperware Brands, the Orlando-based consumer goods company that produces the iconic line of containers, said it was seeking Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection after struggling to revitalize its core business and failing to secure a tenable takeover offer. Despite enjoying the same cultural ubiquity as Kleenex, Teflon, and other brands whose trademark names are eponymous with entire product categories, Tupperware has suffered from waning sales, rising competition, and the limitation of the direct-to-consumer marketing model that once defined its success. In your Market Watch recapping trading on the BISX, from Wednesday, your market movers: Consolidated Water down 11 cents, closing at 525. Emira Incorporated down 4 cents, closing at 950. The BISX All Share Index closing at 2,961.21, down 0.16. That's your Market Watch, and that is your Morning Business Report, brought to you by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations. We are back with Morning Blend, the Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn, along with Laverne Gardner. And, All right, so we're trying to... There's a lot of mischief makers, and I don't... People are very idle. That's the only thing that can be. Oh, man. There's lots of fake videos, folks, trying to cause confusion, and some intentionally. But we're going to try to sort that out about the garden leaf thing. It seems highly unlikely, even for this police force, to do something like that, to take them in, right? So that seems just not possible. Not possible. But we'll. Laverne, you're still there, right? You're muted
yes,
again?
Yes, I okay. am.
Yeah, there we go.
No, I'm here. I'm not on garden leave.
Oh boy. Okay, so let's move on. This is interesting. The Bridge Authority Bill. I'll tell you why it's interesting to me in a bit. But let's hear what's happening here and what they were debating in the House yesterday. Take a listen to this report from our Vonique Toot.
Parliamentarians debate the Bridge Authority Amendment Bill. Works Minister Clay Sweeting announced that the government is seeking funding from key international lenders to address the state of several bridges in the country and to reconstruct the Glasman.
We are looking at 7 bridges across the country, and ACRO is looking at putting a package together so that hopefully we can, with the approval of funding, have bridges across our country. Like in Andrus and Axumo, that their lifespan has almost deteriorated to the point where it's kind of scary for people to drive across these bridges. And we're hoping to finish that package this year, and hopefully once the funding's approved, we can get to moving on some of these.
As for the Glasswindow Bridge, Sweeting said a loan for its reconstruction will be secured through the Bridge Authority, and the loan agreement should be finalized in early 2025. He added it is anticipated construction will be completed in early 2027.
The former Minister of Works and Utilities, the Minister, the Member of Parliament for Fort Charlotte, shared his vision, and with which I support, and not just making it a bridge, but make it a cultural site where you could have cultural events and make it a touristic phenomenon. Inclusive of this, Madam Speaker, Cabinet recently approved the use of UCAF credit support to finance the construction of the Glasswindow Bridge. This approach benefits the government by accelerating and securing financing at competitive rates.
The Works Minister said the Stafford Creek and Fresh Creek bridges in Andros are also in poor condition, while the reconstruction of the ferry bridge in Exuma is long overdue.
The Ministry is in discussions with a key international lender regarding funding with anticipated start date in early 2025. The existing crossings provide vehicular and pedestrian access across 2 waterway channels when we look at the reconstruction of the Barataria bridges. Both bridges are in poor condition, allowing only single-lane traffic, and additionally restricted flow under the bridges is causing severe erosion of the foundations. Preliminary designs are being prepared in-house for a proposed 2-lane bridge with dedicated safe pedestrian access. To minimize construction impact within the water channel, pre-engineered long-span structural steel acro modular units are also proposed for the bridge superstructure.
Sweeting said there are currently 40 bridges across the Bahamas, 17 of which are considered major structures. He described the Bridge Authority Amendment Bill as a progressive and forward-thinking step in how officials manage and maintain national infrastructure. However, he stressed the amendment bill will not mean toll fees at bridges, with the exception of Sir Sidney Poitier Bridge. Deputy Prime Minister Chester Cooper said the amendment bill leverages and mobilizes the assets of the Bridge Authority.
You know, the Bridge Authority has significant assets in tens of millions of dollars. Annual revenues in the region of $10 million a year. A proven track record. And an established management team with great expertise. This bill positions us to leverage these assets more effectively and to draw on the expertise resident at the Bridge Authority.
Okay, so this is good stuff, and we desperately need the Glasswindow Bridge to be addressed, but I feel like I'm living in Groundhog Day. You know, how many times have we said we're going to address the Glasswindow Bridge? And Laverne, I had to go back and say, wait, didn't we just do something? I mean, this. And I look back and I see that in 2021, the government at the time was talking about $35 million for a new glass window bridge that was going to be a world famous attraction. And the former Minister of Works, Desmond Bannister, or I think he was DPM at the time, talked about this. And that this is an article from the Tribune. The government's $30 to $35 million glass window bridge replacement will combine the most ambitious bridge building project with a world famous tourist attraction, the Deputy Prime Minister revealed yesterday. Deputy Prime Minister Desmond Bannister told the Luther Business Outlook Conference that construction on the vital transportation artery would begin in early 2022, with financing phased over a period of 3 years in successive budgets, affirming that the bridge has needed to be replaced for many, many years. He added that the three options presented to the government, it had chosen one that will locate the replacement some 60 feet west of the current version. Yeah, we heard this from then, though. Why are we still here in 2024?
But because who was in government then when this announcement was made?
That time, it was the F&M, yeah.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Right, and it's scheduled to start when? In 2022.
Mm-hmm.
In 2022, that government was no longer...
And so everything goes back to the beginning, goes back to the drawing board again, yes. Under the table. Okay. We're 2 years away from another election. So what does that mean? We may, in 5 years, be talking about a new plan for the bridge in Luthra?
That is very possible.
Okay. This is exhausting.
Unless the work is going to start tomorrow.
This is exhausting. This is... Man, that bridge could have been finished by now. But hey, you know, and I keep talking about this. If we're going to be looking at all these bridges, and in the House it brought up concerns about bridges all over, including in Grand Bahama, many that need to be replaced or refinished in some way. I still think we need to put some money aside to deal with major issues here in New Providence that are going to require, they're not exactly bridges, but going to require overpasses. I keep talking about Gladstone Road. There is no way that can be addressed properly. Definitely can't be a roundabout at John F. Kennedy Drive, Bahamar Boulevard, and Gladstone Road. And I don't think traffic lights are going to work, especially with the way people drive around here. You definitely don't need any left turn on red nonsense happening at that place. You're going to need some sort of overpass system to get traffic moving along Gladstone Road. And I think this would have been a good opportunity to, at least, you know, put some money aside for that. We're going to have to address this at some point. And that might not be the only place where you need to do this. We need to be forward thinking and really, really examining what's happening. It's only going to get worse out there, especially when they expand Gladstone Road, if that's still on the drawing board. The time now to act, and it had to be a toll road too. It might need to be in order to pay for this. But of course, you're going to have to find some alternatives for other people who won't be able to afford the toll. But we've got to be forward thinking. Got to be. All right. So in our final few minutes, Laverne, we got to get a little Junkanoo Valley Boy drama in.
You don't have enough time.
It's a whole show. We did a whole Valley Boys Today show, right?
Yeah.
So you can find out what's going on.
Valley Boys news today.
Right. First half of the show will be for the Way Forward ones, and the other half for the, or should it be reversed? Since anyway. But here is what both groups are saying in response to the JCNP. Again, another report from our Vonik Toot. We still don't have it sorted out? You never got it sorted? No? What? No, okay. Well, anyway. One group said, that, hey, we're happy. And the other one said that...
we're not.
We're not. And we're going to court. We told you that part already.
We were going
yesterday
to the Supreme Court.
Yeah. But since then, it seems like there's been some more developments. Let me see if I can pull this up. This is going to be long. This is going to be very long. So... This is from the original group, the world famous one. They issued a statement. The 18th was yesterday. Dear members, in response to continued threats and actions from the breakaway group, we have taken steps to safeguard the interest and legacy of the Valley Boys. As a result, the Supreme Court today granted an injunction stopping any action regarding the name the Valley Boys. We remain focused on preparing for the upcoming Juggernaut parades. So in the Supreme Junkanoo Group and the Valley Boys Junkanoo Club Limited and the Registrar General and the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Okay, so the claimants were the world-famous Valley Boys Group and the Valley Boys Club Limited. And the first defendant is the Registrar General. And the second defendant is the Attorney General. Right. And so before His Lordship, the Honorable Mr. Justice Darren Ellis, sitting in chambers... upon an application for an interim injunction, as they said. So said, so done.
So they've gone to the Supreme Court first, because the Way Forward Valley Boys were saying that they were going to go to the Supreme Court, but they were going to the Supreme Court. They were going to the Supreme Court so that they could rush as an in-category group. Is that why they were going?
I'm not sure. I think they were trying to stop this group from using the name the Valley Boys. I don't know what's happening.
Anyhow,
the Supreme Court is the place to be.
Right. The Way Forward, after the JCNP continued to stand on business and say this is what it is, our rules, and we're not budging, then the Way Forward said that this matter was going to be going to the Supreme Court, whatever that matter was. Maybe it was everything. But now today, we have the world famous Valley Boys. They've gone to court, to the Supreme Court, to get an injunction on the use of the name Valley Boys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. It'd be great if they would allow people to come to court in costume. That'd be So let's see what our callers are saying. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
One
times. The number for today.
Three times like the police.
Oh, my gosh. That's the number for the day.
I am not surprised. I knew that you would be the first caller once you started talking about this.
I could try to make it quick, right? First of all, let's deduce this. See, the JCNP, I am calling for the JCNP, the management of that grouping, to be disbanded. Because the JCNP is being very duplicitous and very, very selective as to who they deal with. First of all, they say they ain't get nothing from the Registrar General. This is by their lawyer admission 2 days ago on your radio station. Brian also said they never received no information from the Registrar General concerning their name. So what is an injunction for, Dwight? That means they were not telling the truth. An injunction is to stop something from happening.
The JCNP, it wouldn't matter to them.
No, it doesn't matter. But then don't say, I ain't know nothing about it. You can't say that. Well, because obviously Brian knew something and he got something from the Registrar General with reference to changing his name.
Well, that didn't come up in our discussion with the JCNP. But anyway, I mean, we don't know.
Regardless, all them are saying they ain't know nothing. Which means the higher they climb, the more the box size.
No, I don't think that's what they were saying. They're saying it didn't matter to them. They know who was registered with them, and that's
right.
All
the
that they cared
is,
about.
Right. I am saying, Dwight, they was acting like they don't know nothing. You understand? That is what they say on national radio and TV. Second of all,
but you can't let it go like that, though, because they're saying it didn't matter to them. They
fine,
know because
fine,
everybody in Junkanoo knows, but what
fine.
Has that got to do with me as my
but
in
fine.
My role as a JCMP?
But fine. Mm-hmm. Fine, right. If you lie, if the police scare you and you lie about one thing, why you can't lie about the next? So let me move on. The JCMP said on the radio, the Fox Hill Congos came and they tweaked their name, or this one tweaked their name. And if Brian, the court ordered Brian to change his name, or they will allow him in because he's already in. One thing they ain't noticing, the Fox Hill Congos never changed their base name. They may have said Nuke Congos Original, Congos Fox Hill, or One Family Warriors, or Saxon this, or that. If the court ordered Brian to change his entire name because he can't use it, then he needs to be considered a new application. But they already, this is a foregone conclusion, because Dion said from June, one group is going to go A and one going in the fund category from June. This is a foregone conclusion what they're doing.
Okay.
And that is why the Way Forward members say we could take this to court. And yesterday, by their own admission, they say even if the court ordered them, they ain't listen. Obviously, they don't know the meaning of self-governance and autonomy.
Okay,
and
we got to go.
One last thing. Hold on, right.
Really
one last thing.
Mm-hmm.
One last thing. They're calling us new group. But that can't be. We'll change your name. We ain't want to change their name. We have three architects, living architects, founders of the Bali Boys, that founded the Bali Boys and gave them the name, the Bali Boys, the name.
Okay, we got
those points. Pardon me?
I hear you. We got to go. We're out of time, but thank you so much. Appreciate it. This is the drama that keeps giving. These texts before we go, this person says that these foreigners from the south already can't drive. I want to put an overpass for them to be falling off that thing. Like, oh my goodness gracious. And then this text says, Dwight, they're watching on the video stream. You're